Ori.
Yo, what's up?
Yes, I just started watching season 4 of House of Cards.
Oh my god, that came out?
Yeah, it came out today.
Where have you been? It actually made big news because it interrupted, like, internet service.
Are you serious?
Yeah.
Apparently the season's really good, and, like, some people were saying it was even better than the first season, so it's, like, way
better
than the crap we watched last year. It's been
really
good.
Season
3
was pretty poop. I remember watching that with you.
Yeah.
And I was just like, what, the whole time, but season 4, man.
Yeah,
season 4 hype.
Bullshit.
All right, we'll have to check it out. Anyone that spoils the season 4 spoilers is snap getting banned in chat.
I don't know why they would. It's not
Uh-oh.
Like a...
Someone apparently spoiled
you and me, Bob. Yeah, somebody did actually spoil Star Wars in the chat, but Corey totally missed it, so that's fine. Like, he... He didn't know.
What did they say?
They said Han dies.
Oh my god, Corey, not everyone's seen it.
Oh, whoops. it's been...
Wait, are we live right now? Are we already live?
Yeah, we're live right now, yo.
Bro, are we live?
We are Melon's lives.
Didn't you just pull up the stream?
No, I didn't because I was told to watch the Skype.
Oh, okay, well I thought you checked the stream. We're live.
HC Fox says the spoiler is we're going back to Innistrad.
Did you not subscribe to the channel, Bob Huang?
Sorry, I'm not subscribed. I'll remedy that.
It's okay, Bob. Not a lot of people are.
Wow, is that like like a cry for attention there? Like a self-pitying...
Well, I am following the channel, but I don't have it, like, I don't get, like, an email or anything, so I don't know how I would know if you guys are live other than just checking Twitch.
Yeah, I signed up for notifications. Which I actually do on a lot of channels, and I wish Twitch would have an option that's, like, send me at most one per several hours or something, so it could just aggregate these. But, what can you do?
You still have one floating. You can do symbiote again.
So, Bob, have you been? What have you been playing?
So I think my plan is going to be to play lands until Shadows comes out. Just to learn the deck because I think it's really good. And then when Shadows comes out, there's that sweet new counterspell, and I'll probably go back to Delver.
I really like that card. I think that's probably... I'm going to try that out and ruck Delver for a little bit.
Yeah, I don't know. I think it's good enough to make Delver, like, good against lands.
Make Delver good enough against lands. That's a strong statement.
Yeah, it really is. I don't know. I haven't really tested it at all, so who knows. But you know the card I'm talking about, Invasive Surgery?
Yeah.
It's Envelop, and if you have Delirium, you surgically extract as well.
Do you mean it's Envelope?
No, that's has an E.
I'm joking. It just drives people nuts when you say things like that, or when I say things like that.
Yeah, I wasn't playing along.
Thanks, Bob. I always count on you.
How many people you guys got? Corey's in there.
Corey?
that the chat? That's the chat. That's cool. Is there any way to get the screen larger in the Skype?
Sorry, I was AFK. What's going on?
Can you make the screen larger in the Skype?
Did you say you were FKA?
It's not doing that much. Okay, I guess that's helping. Yep, that's good. So Jason's. Jason's on Ely's deck.
I don't know. Cool. Where might we know you, Bob Huang? When
you're on the combo side of it, you're like
I'm scumbag magic celebrity Bob Huang now.
Yeah.
So HC Fox, Bob Huang is the last year's Legacy champion, as well as what Modern IQ winner and innovator of Grizz Shoal brand.
SCG Open champion.
Treasure Cruise is banned because of this asshole. The list goes on.
But also podcasts and future matches.
Actually, I like podcasts. So there is one podcast that I'm technically on the team for, but we're horrible at recording on any schedule. But I think we're going to try to record on Sunday. I think, yeah, it's been like months since our last one. So Green Sun Zenith for age.
Super into magic podcasts because they kind of tend to have a lot of overlap. So there's no real incentive to listen to one over the other. They feature the same guests. It's kind of a small world, you know what I mean?
Yeah, honestly, like, I feel like, I don't know, so reasons to listen to a magic podcast, one, to be entertained, so if the hosts are, like, funny, then that's awesome, and then, like, you know, B, to, like, get better, keep abreast of, like, trends and things like that, or if it's, like, your friend, I guess, I'm not that funny, but there are some funny people on our podcast.
I think maybe it was the most fun when I had a friend who would also listen to the same podcast. So we would always listen to Limited Resources and then talk about it together. And that is kind of what compelled me to stay current with the most recent.
Yeah, I used to listen to that. I loved that podcast when, I forget his name, the Asian guy? What's it? Brian Wong. He was so funny. Do you remember like his sign-offs? Yeah, I don't know. Does LSV still do them or no?
I don't know. I haven't listened in a while because I have no incentive to do it now.
I like almost listened to the podcast because Brian Wong's sign-offs were hilarious. I stopped listening to that because I stopped playing Limited. I don't know. It's definitely one of the top podcasts out there for sure.
That was like a hot minute when you were playing Limited. You're like, I'm moving to Richmond. I'm getting super into Limited. Okay, I'm done.
Yeah. Oh, no, like I still, I don't know, I'm just picking my battles, I guess.
Battles.
Well, yeah, because like I definitely really enjoy competing at a high level, but then I don't have the time or the talent to compete at every format. So now I've mostly settled into doing Legacy with some Modern. Modern, I just play my one deck, and if it's not good, I don't play. I was very close to going to Detroit. I did some good testing, but I couldn't get the Eldrazi matchup to work out the way I wanted it to, so I'm just like not going to go. Yeah,
you
I went.
You want to try playing Eldrazi yourself?
Not really. I don't think the deck is particularly skill intensive, which means that a lot of the times you're just going to lose random mirrors. So my thinking was like, you can show up to Detroit with a deck that beats Eldrazi, but then like loses to like everybody else who just shows up with a regular deck, or you could play the Eldrazi deck and then just like lose random mirrors. So neither of those options was really appealing to me, so I decided not to go.
All right, that's fair enough.
Cool, looks like we are here for round one, and our favorite Jason.
Our favorite Jason. Whoa, not so fast now. There are a lot of worthy Jasons out there.
Let's see, how many Jasons do you know? I can think of two others. Oh, wait, maybe three others? Yeah, I can think of three others.
Like at least seven, but I was joking. This is my favorite Jason.
Nice. Hope your other Jasons aren't watching.
Well, they just have to deal with it. I mean, it'll be a crushing disappointment, but somehow.
Do you actually know seven other Jasons?
Yeah, easily. Like, it's not an uncommon.
Can you like
name.
List all seven Jasons? Because I really can only think of like three, maybe four. Like,
can I list all seven Jasons?
You know what's messed up is I could probably think of like 17 Jasons.
17. Right, snap call. Snap call.
Dude, so you know there's legitimately a game for this, and I can't remember what it's called. Maybe Jason Chevelle. That there's one. Knows what it's called. What's that game where it's like you're geeking off and you're trying to remember the most numbers of something as possible and you bid high until some wits and wagers. Wait, what? No, it's a geek version of it. There's a geek version of it. Alright, well, we'll have to keep you updated on it, but essentially there's a geek waging bidding game where you just say, like, you get a category on a card and it's like movie starring Uma Thurman, and then like you just say like, oh, I know three, and then someone says, oh no, I know four, and you keep going up and up until someone calls you and then you have to list it off,
and then you score points or lose points.
Am I here? Sorry, I stepped away for like a minute to get coffee.
Yeah, I don't really know what happened. Corey cut off.
Uh-oh, okay.
Yeah,
well,
I muted my mic there. I was done talking. It's really, really loud here, so I'm keeping my mic muted.
Okay, no worries.
It's not bad now, like when you're talking. I think a few minutes ago it was a bit louder. When I first signed on, it was a bit loud.
I went to get my sheets so I could curl into a ball and be warm.
That's what my dog's doing right now, too.
Oh, he's impersonating Emoji by being a ball.
He's impersonating Bob Pong.
Ooh, because I'm a person.
Yeah. Anyway, I got my coffee. It's a super late tournament. It starts at 9.
Yeah, I know. It's so late. Jesus. Wait, no, I'm being serious. I guess we're just like old men and ladies.
You have the worst serious tone of voice I've ever heard.
Oh.
Oh okay. My gosh. Jeez, it's so late. I'm being serious.
Well, okay, no, like 9 is not a problem, but then like, if it ever hits like 1 or whatever, just like, so there was an FNM I went to that was like, it started at 7, which was fine, but it was like 4 rounds cut to top 8, and I was just like, what the fuck? Are you guys really staying here?
This is what happened.
And like, what else was ridiculous about the FNM was it was free, which I was like, oh, this is awesome. But then it was like, for each person, there was $1 in store credit or whatever. So I was like, yeah, okay, I'm definitely leaving.
This was like when we went to Kentucky and wanted to play at, I think, Troll and Toad. Their FNM just went on forever, and eventually we left because we wanted to go to the PTQ tomorrow, or the next day after that.
Oh yeah, I remember that. Like, you actually went to Kentucky for a PTQ?
Yeah, it was fun.
Like, how far away was that?
12 hours.
What? Grindr, Diana, run. Jesus.
This was back in the day. I'm not like that anymore. I don't have the chops to keep up.
2 years ago, and it was Tyler, right?
Yeah. I don't have the chops to keep up with you young people anymore on the circuit.
Wow. Aren't you, like, I'm trying to think. You're the same age as me. I'm pretty sure you're the exact same age as me, right?
I'm retired. So actually, you're a little bit younger than me. But, yes, we're around the same age.
Okay. That is what I thought. Okay, maybe we should actually commentate on Magic. I don't know if people care or not. Maybe they don't care. Maybe we should just talk about other things and never talk about the screen, but...
What is Magic? Oh, yes, these are some Magic the Gathering cards. Yes.
Yeah, perfect. Okay. So we're seeing what I'm going to guess is pretty close to Ely's Blue-Red Delver list, which made top 8 of the most recent Open, mm-hmm. up against Miracles. Overall, I think I like Miracles in this matchup. I like Miracles against all Delver decks, really. I think it's going to be, you know, more on the Miracle side to make the correct plays, and I think it's harder to play from that end, but that's overall how I feel about the matchup. All right, so it looks like, yeah, Abe went for an end step Brainstorm to set up his Terminus, which Jason knew about, and he's able to counter here with a Force of Will. Let's see what Abe's got. Doesn't look like he has his own Force of Will, so might have to just let that resolve and try to find another Terminus. This is what I love.
Abe's... Go ahead.
No, you go ahead.
Oh, okay. I was going to ask you if you think Abe is starting to, like, slide onto the back foot here, because it looks like he might be under some pressure now.
Mm-hmm. Oh, definitely. I would say that... Wow, see, he has 6 power on the board. This is why I love Young Pyromancer against Miracles. I would say that if Abe doesn't find a Terminus in the next 2 turns, he's dead.
Right, and Jason has another Force in hand, so keep that in mind, too.
Yeah, although he might have an Engineered Explosive. No, maybe not. So this is what I've been seeing is a very recent trend on Magic Online, is that Miracles players are main decking 1 Ratchet Bomb or 1 Engineered Explosive to fight the uptick in Chalice of the Void and Eldrazi Stompy, which I like. So okay, that could be another potential answer, like Ratchet Bomb plus Swords to Plowshares or something like that. But more likely than not, he's going to need a Terminus or he's dead.
Yeah, this is definitely not a situation that a Miracles player wants to see themselves in, being a slower deck that doesn't have tools to immediately come back.
Yeah, I think without question, Young Pyromancer is the best threat any Delver deck, any creature threat any Delver deck has against Miracles, because of what you see here. It's you force them to answer with a Terminus. Because the Swords to Plowshares right here would still just be too slow.
Right.
All right, well, he's going for an even slower one, which is Council's Judgment. Honestly, so it looks like Jason actually has another Force of Will. He's debating whether or not to cast it.
Right, because that's his answer against Terminus. Really big spells like Terminus, right? Well, okay, he's going to go for it.
Yep, he's going to go for it. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So now... This play puts a very close to Lightning Bolt range. But if Abe does find a Terminus next turn, Jason's going to need another follow-up.
Thanks, Fox, for that commentary.
Who is that guy?
Looks like they're going to just go on to the next game here.
Yep. Abe saw that he did not have Terminus, so you just go ahead and scoop him up. Looks like he has Enlightened Tutor in his board, which is nice. I actually, my very first GP I ever played was GP Denver, and I played Rip Energy Field Helm Enlightened Tutor Miracles. was pretty excited to make day two, but I had three buys, so I went like, I guess it was like 3-0 and then 4-2 to make day two, so.
I thought you said your first tournament was in France or something. Am I remembering someone else's story?
Oh yeah, no, so my first tournament, I got my DC I number in Paris. Before that I had just played casually. But my first Grand Prix was in Denver.
Gotcha. Yeah.
Hey Bob, what's the name of that new envelope? Do you remember what it's called?
I think it's called Invasive Surgery.
Yeah, that's right. Invasive Surgery. That's the one J-Tron was asking about.
Yep. I just love it because it covers so many bases, and it's so insane if you get to surgical their loams.
Yeah. Surgicaling their loams. It's instant or sorcery, right?
Lewis is watching. Hey, Lewis.
I think that also gets like Punishing Fire, too. Although I have a feeling like the new lists are just going to be mono Molten Vortex and foregoing the Punishing Fire combo.
Well, like those lists are even weaker to Surgical because if you don't have Life from the Loam, your only game plan, like Vortex isn't that good without Life from the Loam. It's going to be like it does something, but it's not going to be good. They really need to go for like Dark Deaths combo, and then that's like, you know, another angle you do have to cover, but.
Right. I definitely agree with that because without the Loom engine, you're not really netting cards or you know, driving that engine forward.
Yeah, I think if you extracted their Loams, like, and they still had Punishing Fire left in their deck, then, you know, you still have, like, two more angles to cover. You have to cover Punishing Fire and Merit Lodge. But now if the lands decks go away from Punishing Fire and more towards Abrupt Decay, which I think is totally reasonable given the uptick in Chalice and Counterbalance, but yeah, that makes it easier for the Delver player, so I like where Delver's headed. And I've been practicing lands. I really like the deck, or I think the deck is really good, and I'm like starting to enjoy playing it too. It just very weird. It feels so wrong to me. Like, I feel like guilty playing with it sometimes.
You have a lot of emotions about this deck.
Well, I'm really sick of losing to it. Not as sick as I am of Miracles, but yeah, I mean, I feel guilty because it's just like, you're not playing by the rules at all. You have a demonic tutor in your deck called Gamble, you have a tinker in your deck called Crop Rotation, and you also have an Ancestral Recall called Life from the Loam. And you have Moxen.
Oh, wait a minute. Did we miss something here? They're drawing 7 right now? Like, what? Did this just take the longest shuffle ever?
I didn't feel like it was unusual.
Oh, okay. I thought they were resolving mulligans, but they just drew 7.
I checked out slightly. So. J-Tron, so we're all in a variety of different places. Okay, I guess Corey just answered. But yeah, it's like DC, Baltimore area.
The DMV.
Doesn't it bother me being unfair game? Yeah, I mean, you're definitely a dog, but I don't think the combo decks are very good right now. Like, Storm has to play against Chalice. I think the best combo deck might be, like, Show and Tell right now. And if you know what you're trying to beat, like, Legacy is a format where sideboard cards are really powerful. And I think lands post-board can be favored against decks like Sneak and Show. Alright, so Abe lost the first game. He's on the play. He's got an old foil. Do you know Abe, Diana? Does he usually play Miracles?
I know of him, but I am not familiar with what he usually plays, no.
Okay. Yeah.
He's usually on Rug Delver.
Okay. Do you know if that's his deck, or if he's, like, borrowing it or something?
Borrowing it.
Do you think his playstyle is strange?
Can't say too much about that. I just thought I knew all the players with Shiny Miracles decks.
Gotcha. I didn't know if you were pointing out a certain unfamiliarity with the deck.
Yeah, it didn't seem like there was too much you could have done last game. Alright, looks like you got the turn one, top turn, do counterbalance. Jason has a force of will. And A will send it back.
Yeah, I love playing a deck like that where you don't have to be really shy about using your forces. They're there for you to fend off whatever you need to. Like, I think some other decks, if you're playing maybe Stunblade or another control deck like that, you have to really think hard if you're going to force something. Think harder, at least.
Are you talking about Miracles here?
Or Miracles, in this case, yeah. I was saying that Jason can afford to force things kind of more freely because he's there to burn through his cards and kill his opponent. You don't think that's accurate?
Yeah, so I would disagree with that because I think, like, I mean, so Force of Will is free in a mana sense, but it's obviously
it's
not free. Like,
right.
Yeah, like you're costing some resources. So, like, there are definitely matchups where you board out Force of Will. And then there are other times where you need to pick your spot to use your Force of Will. So I think it's totally reasonable to try and force counterbalance. It's quite possible he's going to be locked out of casting spells for a while. So this is game plan Miracles wants. It wants an empty board and countertop in play. And it just causes so many nightmares for most other decks. So Jason's probably going to be looking for, like, I don't know, ideally like a 3-mana threat to be able to keep playing Magic.
Right.
Back to what I was originally saying about Force of Will. Yeah, you want to pick your spots. So, like, last game, it could have been possible that Abe was baiting the Force with the Council's Judgment.
Right.
And then, like, you know, later had a Terminus to set up. And then, you know, he had a shot at winning the game from there. So I don't want to say, like...
That's absolutely true.
Yeah, I don't want to say Jason's Force was... incorrect or whatever, but it's just an example of a thing where you could, like, you know, there's an argument for timing your forces.
Oh, I agree. I don't think, you know, anybody can just force anything anytime, but I just mean if you're not planning to use your cards for the next 50 turns like Miracles is, then you have a little more freedom to use them.
Yeah, what's going on with the show? Oh, it's a rip sleeve.
Yeah, replacing Rip Sleeve. So.
Cool. Yeah, I definitely think you want to play Abrupt Decay and Delver. And I think Young Pyromancer, Cabal Therapy is like the best combination of threats against Miracles in combo. So, 4-color is probably the Delver deck that I favor. Very similar to what Lewis played when he top 8-ed. So I'll likely be on that once Shadow comes out. I also think the best way to get to trigger Delirium on Invasive Surgery is Cabal Therapy, because a lot of decks like Miracles and combo don't put creatures into your graveyard. So I kind of like Cabal Therapy as a roundabout way of doing that.
Oh yeah, absolutely. I like Cabal Therapy a lot after this set.
Oh, it's Romario, hey. Romario is a well-known Legacy streamer. He's also, I would say, my favorite Richmond Legacy player.
Aw, it's adorable.
And he has an awesome pug.
Is that kind of redundant, though? Like, awesome pug? Mm. You just say pug?
Great point. I lie down corrected.
Are you lying down right now?
Well, I'm on my couch wrapped in sheets. So I'm half lying down.
You're like a spooky little Legacy playing ghost.
All right, so Jason's actually just on one land, so he was hoping, I guess, that it would not remove the top, because removing the top is potentially a risky play. It opens up the chance that, like, in response to tapping the top, you could pyroblast it or something. But Jason never had the extra mana, so Abe felt pretty safe about tapping the top. And so now Jason's definitely locked out of ones, and potentially of other casting cost spells as well. This is why it's pretty infuriating playing against Miracles.
I definitely remember my first time I ever saw that deck. I didn't know about it. I hadn't seen it before. I just played against it, and I was on Storm, and I couldn't understand what was happening to me or why. I was just like, why would the universe allow this to happen?
Now, that's a really aggressive Jace.
Right. Just putting it out there, tapping out.
Yeah. Like, although he had force in his hand, so if
Right, he
Jason
had
did have
force.
days, right.
He has his ones and twos covered. That's pretty safe.
All right, so he's going for a Null Rod to try and stop the countertop combo. Abe goes ahead and burns his force here. Right, he's just trying to fate seal his way to victory over here.
I think that's not a bad idea when your opponent's really down on their luck and you have them locked out. Get there quickly if you want to get there at all.
So I like the Fate Seal route once you have like one counter spell or something. What's
I mean,
that just
well,
put up?
here's the thing. He has his ones and twos covered, so Jason can't really do anything. It's not like.
Well, when he first had the Jace, so he had yeah. I mean, I think you're right. I'm not sure if he knew he had a two on top. If he knew he had a two on top, I definitely agree. You have the game mostly locked up. You just want to end it before
Right,
Jason.
there was the one turn when the Jace was first cast.
Yeah,
It's a
I
little
think
iffy.
Jason's outs that game would be like something. I mean, by then it was a little too late, but something like Sulfuric Vortex, like the Null Rod that you saw, or I'm trying to think of other stuff. Like, I guess he could just, happen to resolve a two or something like that. Or he could play, I don't know, I've seen like Set Adrift, other interesting
That's
card choices.
spicy.
Yeah, Anurag, he's been like playing this build of miracles with lots of predicts. Predict works really well with Set Adrift.
Oh boy.
Yeah, because you're like, I predict Chalice of the Void. Oh wow, you had that. I'll draw two. So I have always kind of disliked Miracles for more reasons than one. One reason is that I lost to it a lot. I don't like losing. Another reason is I thought it was too good. And then a third reason is like I hate tournaments that take forever. And Miracles had all three of those categories. So that was definitely why, like, I really disliked the deck. I played it myself, actually, a little bit. I played it at an open. I think I went like 6-3 or something, and then I played it. I actually won like a Richmond. Actually, was that with Miracles? Well, I think it was with Miracles, but yeah, I won like a Richmond tournament with Miracles. So I have played the deck. Really powerful, really skill intensive, but it was just like not what I wanted to be doing, and it also hurt my my brain. So that's why I really like right now how Miracles is still going to be one of the best decks, but the rise in like Eldrazi Stompy and Chalice of the Void makes it a little bit worse. So I definitely like that it's not going to be like 15% or 20% of a room anymore. Or at least it's not as beats everything as it used to be.
It's not as beats everything as it used to be.
Yeah.
There's a sentence. All right, that was a pretty quick one from Abe, actually. He stabilized quickly and closed it out soon after.
I don't know that. I guess Jason only played one thread the entire game, and it just got eaten up by Sword Splash Airs.
Right.
All right, starting off with a turn one Delver again.
I know you're kind of like a resident expert on Delver decks, but man, leading with that turn one Delver, when I tried out playing Delver, always made me feel uncomfortable.
What do you mean?
You know, here's a card that I kind of expect to carry the game for me, right? Like, Delver is one of the big sources of damage through the game, and I just put it out there on turn one. Just run it out there immediately. It just made me feel so aggressive and uncomfortable. I'm definitely a conservative player. I like to do things slowly and in time.
Yeah, Delver, not the deck for you. For me, it's just like, oh, here's this really dumb card that kills my opponent really quickly. Let's hope some magic happens and it turns over. And it usually does.
Yeah, I remember the first time I was playing someone else's Delver deck, and I don't remember who I borrowed the deck from, but they actually had some skill with it, and they were looking over my shoulder. And after the game, they were like, why were you just holding on to your Delver? Who does that? Like, why would you ever do that? And I think I said something like, well, I didn't want to risk putting him out there.
That's funny. That's good that you care about your troops. I'm sure they respect you more for it.
I wanted to protect the little guy, little bug.
All right, so he's able to flip it to a bolt. Some nice damage output right there.
Kind of the.
I wonder. Team. Yeah, I wonder what Jason had in his sideboard for this matchup. I didn't think we saw too much last game. We saw the Null Rod.
Right, I'm wondering that as well. Do you know the sideboard?
I don't know his exact list. Do you remember seeing Wasteland at all in any of these games?
No, I have not seen one.
Yeah, so it could be that he... like, so there's really two variants of Blue Red Delver. There's like a version that's pretty aggressive with Swift Spears, and then there's like a slower version that plays like more Wastelands. I think that's okay, a Wasteland.
Cora says in chat that this deck does run Wasteland.
Yep, okay, so it looks like it's probably similar to Ely's deck. And so, like, the sideboard hate cards that I expect to be good would be, you know, I did see a Pyroblast. So Pyroblast, Null Rod, I think Sulfuric Vortex is really the big one. If he has Pithing Needle, that's pretty good as well.
Right, that's kind of the conventional package against Miracles.
Yep, looks like he's going to go ahead and follow up the Delver with a Pyromancer. So this play really forces Abe to have a Terminus soon, if he doesn't answer the Pyromancer.
Right, did you catch what is in Abe's hand right now?
I saw some forces. So my guess is if he doesn't have a way to kill the Pyromancer, he's going to have to force it. Or he might have a counterspell. That's what this looks like. Yep, counterspell.
Yeah. Okay, I see Jason, yep, has the Force. Do you think he would do the same thing to just run that Pyromancer out there? I think that's a really good trade, actually. Because I would suspect that Abe kind of kept a hand on the strength of its counter magic, since he hasn't run out a permanent yet.
Yeah, well, I think he knows Abe didn't have he knew when, okay, so when Abe, I guess he didn't know if Abe had a Swords of Plashers or not. It's kind of reasonable to take one hit from Delver.
Uh-huh.
But yeah, Abe just happened to top deck Swords of Plashers. I'm a Brainstorm guy. Yeah, I don't know. You can't deny that Brainstorm is the best card in the format. But I like to play other decks too. I actually have always had a soft spot for like Chalice of the Void and Mud.
Oh boy, wow. We are seeing the side of Bob here today that is quite frankly unexpected.
Forbidden Thoughts.
Yeah.
Okay, so now Abe's in okay shape. He just needs to find like a Snapcaster Mage or a Swords of Plowshares. Which, by the way, I honestly feel like Snapcaster Mage is the reason why, like, I think Miracles used to be okay against Delver, but, like, ever since people started adopting Snapcaster Mage in larger numbers, that's when I felt like the matchup really shifted in Miracles' favor.
I really like that card because it covers two of your weaker spots, right? So one is the card advantage, because a lot of the cantrips in blue decks give you card parity, but they don't actually give you card advantage. Yeah. And the other is just having some type of board presence. So it covers two bases at once.
Yep. Yeah, I also like just Snapcaster's almost like pure versatility. Like, it's going to be good against the fair decks because you can flash back your Swords to Plowshares. And it's going to be good against the combo decks too because you're just going to be flashing back your counter spells.
Right. Oh yeah, as the game goes long, that it's definitely absolutely dangerous to see that Snapcaster come down because there's so much selection out of the graveyard.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you don't see this quite as much in Legacy, but then like in Modern, for example, there's so many 2-for-1s, like Cryptic Command or Colligan's Command. Mm-hmm. So just like when you play Snapcaster in conjunction with those cards, it does really absurd things.
Well, Modern's quite the format of 2-for-1s.
Is Thought Not Seer a 2-for-1?
I'm sorry? What did you say?
Is Thought Not Seer a 2-for-1?
I don't know. What would you say?
I think it is. I think Thing is a 2-for-1 that you get a bonus if you manage to kill it. You, like, level up, draw a card.
Yeah. Okay. I'd buy that.
What do I think of the new Black Delver card? I was pretty excited to see it. It's not good enough for anything other than, like, you know, Cube, perhaps. Unless there's, like, some crazy synergy with Madness.
Right, I want to play in a Madness deck. I think it's really cool. But I think the drawback that it doesn't share with the old Madness outlets is you can only activate it once per turn.
Yeah, I don't know how much, like, so there's never really been, like, a quote-unquote Madness deck in Legacy. There's, like, Survival was the closest, and I was playing Basking Rootwalla. Like, that's the only Madness card I can think of. I guess maybe people were playing, like, I heard people were playing Arrogant Worm. I don't know if that was, like, a major thing.
That's too far back in Legacy's history for me, honestly. I did not start playing the format until just a couple years ago.
Yeah, as far as I know, like, Basking Rootwall was the only Madness card that saw play, and it was with Survival of the Fittest. Well, yeah, Blue-Green Madness was a thing in Standard. Yeah, so for me, like, the new Delver is, like, two major drawbacks. Three, I guess. One, it costs two instead of one. Two, it costs you a card to flip instead of just incidentally flipping for free. And so if they kill it, it's like effectively a 2-for-1 for your opponents.
Right.
And 3 is a more minor drawback, but it's not blue. Which is
that's
a real drawback.
Huge drawback.
Which is a real drawback in Legacy. You can look at every single card that's not blue and be like, hey, you're not blue. You're slightly worse. Alright, so Abe's going for the Desperation Vendilion click. I love how little we're actually commentating. Oh, wow. He's got the Force of Will. So Abe is trying to trade his Vendilion click with the Delver, and Jason... Abe is actually out of cards, so if Jason's able to find a Daze here off the Brainstorm, he's got it, because Abe is now down to 3.
Oh boy, this is an interesting stack here.
Yeah, he's Brainstorming, which he just Brainstormed onto the ground, and now he's going to try to find a Daze. 3. I think he found a Force and a blue card, so that's going to be good enough. Oh, wait. Force. Okay, he won. So Jason won. The reason I'm kind of confused is I thought the click was already in play, and I thought the lightning bolt was targeting the click.
No, they were on the stack together, I thought.
So he was... So in that case, I disagree with Jason's play, because if he was lightning bolting...
Gives,
if he,
that gives
if he lightning
an
bolted,
opportunity, right, to make the decision
yeah.
on how... How that stack resolves. I agree.
Well, no. So what I'm saying is, if you let the click resolve and you bolt the click, you still have a Delver getting in for 3 every turn. If you bolt Abe, he goes down to 1, but then the click trades with the Delver, and then you know Abe at 1 is not as good as Abe, you know, or as you having a Delver in play. So that's why I was a little confused. Like, so Abe was at 4 life, and you're saying what happened was Jason bolted Abe to try to get Abe down to 1 life, but then if the bolt resolved and if the click resolved, then they just trade off, and then Abe's at 1, and Jason's not really winning the game. So that's what I'm trying to say.
Yeah, no, I know what you're saying, and I tend to agree with you. I think Jason's reasoning might have been that he didn't want to lose the bolt out of his hand, potentially, if Abe targeted him with the click's ability.
So if the click targeted Jason, which you know presumably it would, or I guess you don't know if it would or not, but
yeah,
if the click targeted Jason, then you can bolt, then I would have bolted the click in response.
Right.
And then, you know, that would take Abe down to 1, and then I have a Delver on board. So that's what I thought was going to happen. Yeah.
Well, like you said, this was a tough matchup for Miracles.
Oh, really? No, I felt the other way.
Oh, really? I didn't think that's what you said at the beginning
of
the game.
Oh, friendship. I love me
Aww,
some good
now
friendship.
Kiss. Now smooch.
So I like Miracles' position because the really only card that gives you fits is Young Pyromancer. Mm-hmm. And if you're able to control Young Pyromancer, like, ultimately, you know, Jason's deck is really vulnerable to counterbalance, as you saw in game 2, and just has enough cards to grind through. Enough removal to grind through Jason's other threats.
Okay, I see what you're saying. My impression, I guess, was that Miracles would have a hard time stabilizing in the beginning of the game, but maybe that's always true for them.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think it's somewhat true. But if they ever stabilize with a countertop, like, nothing Jason really does will be very effective.
Right.
Who is support only?
Who is what?
Someone loves me. I like love.
Support only? Is that a League of Legends username?
Also, he said ding ding, which was my college ultimate frisbee team. That was like our cheer.
Ooh. All right. Someone from your past.
I don't know. Maybe.
A or mysterious could just be like character something. From your past.
Could be. Who knows? It is a league username, Diana. You were right. But also, it's someone from... Okay, I'm going to guess... Which of my Dartmouth friends, like, watch Magic or knows I play Magic? It might be Dan. Tell us an embarrassing story about Bob. Oh my god, there's so many embarrassing stories about me.
Oh, I totally believe that.
Let's see what this support only comes up with.
Hey guys, just a quick update. We're waiting on one game right now. It's Eldrazi versus Miracles. And then we'll be good to start the next round.
Cool.
I kind of like that flavor-wise. Eldrazi versus Miracles.
Just like the two deck names?
Yeah, you know. So Miracles came out of Divine Intervention in Innistrad, right? Like, immortal beings intervening against the grisly fate of that plane. And Eldrazi, of course, are these, like, big plane-destroying creatures. So that would be a pretty epic battle.
Yeah, do you follow the storyline at all?
I did for a while, but there is too much to keep up with.
My favorite things are, like, the stories on storylines on Reddit that are, like, TLDR.
I'll have to check that out. Actually, my eyes kind of started glazing over when I was looking at the Magic subreddits.
Oh, so Paul's still on Eldrazi. Cool. He was one of the early innovators of the deck. He actually basically had the entire core of the deck together before, Team Channel Fireball and East West Bowl lit up the Pro Tour. He had, like, all the right creatures already. So that was pretty cool to see. I'm kind of disappointed I don't get to hear an embarrassing story about myself.
Well, you could always tell us an embarrassing story about yourself, Bob.
Yeah, okay, recently I feel like I've been too, like, self-promotional, which is why I was like, you can take my name out of the title. So I'm trying to turn that back.
Too late, now it's in the
title.
Wow,
yeah, that train has left the station, Bob. Choo-choo.
Ding ding.
You don't want to build your brand? You could be like Kanye West.
Oh my god, I love me some Kanye, but he's not a human being I want to emulate.
Ouch.
Ooh, Jason's hands. Ooh, Jason's thumbs.
God, I'm trying to think of which embarrassing story of Bob I want to start with.
Wow, not you. Go away. Nobody likes what? You.
Yeah, what? Go away.
What? I can't. Oh, man. I could probably think of one or two. Not really embarrassing. Actually, it's probably more embarrassing for Jarvis, but I remember when we were yelling at him for picking ice cream. Or was that... No, that was you, Bob. Yeah, that's a qualifying embarrassing story.
Wow, what? It's more of an embarrassing story about you, Corey, that you can't tell Jarvis and Bob apart.
I couldn't remember who it was embarrassing for. I forgot. I kind of forgot the story. And then I remembered it as I started saying it.
Great story, yep.
Cool story.
A roller coaster ride from beginning to end.
Is there a Vincent over here? Oh, the Miracles. Oh, man. Oh, boy. They're apparently going to Game 3.
Wow.
Jesus.
This is why I hate Miracles.
And they, like, they just, they, I turned away and I just saw they just started, so I can't even pull them over here.
Oh my goodness. Paul, you're letting me down.
Maybe I have enough time for a deck tech with somebody. I have Brian on high tide. He'd probably like to do a deck tech.
If they just started game three, why didn't you get them in?
Because I literally turned away and then looked back and saw they started.
Oh no! All right.
It's funny how the Eldrazi are the good guys in Legacy and the bad guys in Modern.
Oh yeah, Jason, what list were you playing? Are you around?
I think they have a reputation.
His 75. Okay, so apparently Jason was playing Ely's 75 from Philly.
Cool.
We got confirmation.
Yeah, Jason's had a soft spot for all the Volcanic Island themed decks.
Yeah.
So I figured he'd try something new. That's cool.
Is it just because he owns Volks?
No, he actually does, like,
I know. Delver.
He's been on that deck for a while.
It's his style.
Agreed.
Actually, Volks are a really good land for him, because that's his color identity.
Volks have been, like, the best lands in Legacy for a long time.
What? Not Seas? Come on.
No. So Volk has seen way more play than Seas, like, since before Blue-Red Delver.
Yeah. But, poll.
There's
audience
a
Volks versus Seas. Go. Choose your side.
We can actually do this in chat.
Oh, really? Okay.
I'm trying to remember the command.
I want to see this.
You can use MTG bot to poll the audience.
I need to remember the command. I need a second.
Technology. So Underground Sea has always been the most expensive, except for like a short period during the cruise era. But Volcanic Island's always seen more play. But blue black is kind of like cooler.
Black is the best color. Anybody who says otherwise is just lying to themselves.
Well, black is like just like a different dimension of blue, really.
I don't think that's true. Oh. I can't follow directions. Ha ha ha, guys!
Wow, everyone's winning? Jeez. Or by everyone, I mean.
Someone said plateau.
Poor old plateau.
Even
getting trolled in a online vote.
I'm only saying C because it's reanimator color. Otherwise, I honestly think Volk is seeing more play currently.
I'm
with
Bob.
That's
not even how plateau is spelled. Oh, poor plateau. I'm sorry.
Fifteen seconds left. I'm actually not even on Twitch right now, so I can't even vote. It's not fair.
Bob.
I'm sure I would have been the tiebreaker, or I would have swung it the other way. Oh. Or not.
Oh, look at that, guys. That was fun. We should do more of these polls. What's a good...
Yeah, the command's really easy. You can have as many data types, I guess, and they're just comma delimited.
Wow, if someone is, like, watching us from Europe right now, it's, like, pretty late. Plus 5 hours.
Dude, we get lots of foreign viewers. We get Europeans, Australians. We get a lot of Brazilians.
Australia makes more sense than Europe. It's, like, 2 a.m. over there.
Yeah, shout outs.
It's like 10. It's like 3 a.m. over there. What are we voting?
Oh my gosh, you voted for yourself, Corey. What a shameless self-promoter.
Yeah, what are we voting on exactly?
Betting on commentators.
AM. Wow, people are just so young and youthful and full of energy.
Alright, Corey can vote for himself. I can vote for myself.
Who's gonna vote for me? I'm not on Twitch.
Your friend voted for you. Support only voted for you.
Yeah, and then someone tried to vote for me, but they got my name wrong. I demand a recount.
Ooh, it's a two-way tie, or just a tie, simple tie, I guess, between me and Corey. Alright, we'll have to duel to the death, Corey. We'll have to Yu-Gi-Oh! Duel to the death.
I think they were asking for what country in Europe.
I don't know. I can't. You know what? I can't process.
Well, yeah, we're in Borbering most. Oh, Chris. Oh, what else can we do to pass time? Have you guys seen the new spoilers?
We could get a match on camera.
It's probably a little late for that now. I totally should have done a deck deck with somebody. Punt.
Anything spicy going around?
Brian's on high tide. We got a couple aggro loan players here, actually. Pretty hyped.
Nice.
Yeah, one of them is running the Dark Depths combo. Let's see what else. Got Blue Red Delver, Eldrazi, two or three Miracles. Sneak and Show. Actually, we had three Miracles in the room.
Gotcha. So if there's one deck I hate more than Miracles, it's High Tide. It's my least favorite deck.
What?
Wow. That's quite a strong statement there.
It's so boring to play against. Oh my god. I'd rather watch someone actually jerk it, because then at least they make funny faces.
So what you're saying is you want to cover it next round? Because he won.
I mean, I'm not the one going through the torture, I guess. His opponent is, so.
I mean, I'd rather watch someone jerk it, but that has nothing to do with High Tide. Sorry, what? Are we live, guys?
What? It's recorded. It's in the books now. Can't not undo it.
We're watching Abe stack some dice here.
Dude, that guy's got the bling.
That's not Abe, by the way.
Yeah, definitely not Abe.
Oh, sorry. I'm not paying attention.
Dude, that watch. Holy crap. Let's see that. Wow, that is huge.
Is that the guy who works at HQ?
Nice, yeah.
Okay. I was just watching the dice.
What's up? Oh. Yeah, I can tell you.
I have like a really miniature version of the stream on right now, because it's my like Skype preview window thing.
Uh-huh.
Well, I have another window up.
Yep, that is how they work. Jason figured out how the timer glyph dice worked.
Oh wow, your dice goes all the way up to 8-9.
Well, we have two 600.
Yeah, that's cool.
But I mean, like, one picks up where the other leaves off.
Yeah, no, that makes sense. I've never seen an 8-9 Tarmogoyf.
Oh,
I've seen 6-7, 7-8.
So story time. I've beaten my opponent to death with an 8-9 Tarmogoyf before in Aggrolome. I was playing against Black-White Tokens, and I Abrupticade his Bitter Blossom, and I Punishing Fired his Soren. And then I Green Sun Zenith for Tarmogoyf.
Nice.
That tribal enchantment. I'm not paid to do this. Excuse me. Sorry. I am not paid for this. However, we are going to be getting a sponsor for the stream soon. And we'll be playing commercials in between rounds. A very short commercial. And it'll be pretty obvious who will be paying me for that. But no, I don't charge the shops a thing. If they like give me a soda or something, then like that's on them. But I don't even get any like special deals or anything. But I'm doing this mostly for the shop. But anyway, round two. I'll be right back.
Dropping some hints there. Hey, it'd be cool if they give me a soda.
Wow, that's some great flavor text, Haugland.
Oh, this is funny, Corey. I just got a notification about one of those Facebook memories that's like something that happened on this day some number of years ago. And this one's with you, and it's a cardboard crack panel. I'm gonna share it. It's about Magic the Gathering. Yeah. Can I post links? Because I'm a mod.
Yes. Sorry, I totally missed whoever that follow was, but thank you.
Bob Rigmas. Hey, Bob. Looks like you have a question.
Yeah, I don't know if I want to address that, if I'm addressed that way. Otherwise, I'm going to get another name.
Sorry.
Legacy champion
Bob Rigmas.
Katana Bob Rigmas. How come I didn't get a magic question? This one's for Corey and Bob. Corey and Bob.
Wow! Hella rude.
I know, right? Some people.
Just like.
Some people are just like not suitable for human establishments. This fine game shop. Everyone's talking about you, Bob.
All right. Ooh, this is a matchup I'm going to enjoy. I wonder who won the last match between Paul and the Miracles player. So, like, if they're 1-0 or 0-1.
It was a draw.
Whoa, a draw. That's spicy.
Okay, cool. Well, I don't know this Kyle Marks. Maybe he had, like, you know, grandfather that liked communism, perhaps.
Is this Brian Marks' brother?
Okay.
Is it, Corey?
Yep, sorry, I just realized my mic was muted. Yeah, he's Brian Marks' younger brother.
The whole family in here.
Was there like a comedy duo that were like the Marx Brothers as well. Am I making that up?
Yeah, like Groucho Marx, yep.
Yeah, okay, the Marx Brothers, yeah, nice.
You're not making that up.
The sixth Marx Brother, okay. Cool.
So I have a real quick shout out. So after Josh gave us a donation Tuesday, Donald Dooley donated $20 with no message.
Money.
So just shout outs to Donald for that. That's awesome. That's the second time he's donated for the stream. So shout outs.
What sick upgrades should we expect to see coming with all this money rolling in?
If I can unmute my mic. There we go. Okay, so we're looking at face cams. We're getting a whole new camera set. We're getting new cabling so we can do local commentary a lot more easily and appropriately. And we're going to be getting face cams and likely typing up the sideboards while the players play. So we get a nice shot of their face and you get to see their sideboard as they are sideboarding.
Nice.
So that's all in the works right now. I'm also working on software improvements to the stream as well as starting up some other side series. But anyway, the match is starting, so.
Wow, so this is an awesome start from Paul Lynch. Turn one chalice is where you want to be in Legacy. And it's not very good against Death and Taxes, but on the plate, game one or turn one is still going to be very good because you shut off Swords of Plowshares, Mother of Runes doesn't really do anything, but you also shut off Aether Vial, which is huge. Whereas on the draw, like you might not be able to do that much against Aether Vial.
Do you think that Wasteland is correct? I mean, I know the Ancient Tomb is very very valuable land, but just going back a turn against Chalice on one seems like it's not ideal.
I think it was almost definitely correct because the Eldrazi deck is very, very mana hungry.
Okay.
And then it's just gonna. I think it's just way more powerful, and I think the Chalice on one doesn't really, incentivize you to play any differently because.
Well, you're out really just the Aether Vial and I guess you're a one drop. Creatures
well, yeah.
And swords.
Also, it's not a clock in and of itself.
Right.
Okay. Wow, this is just a really good start for Paul, and Kyle's kind of stuck on lands, which is why he decided not to go Wasteland here.
Fox, it's the most recent land. He played Ancient Tomb, Cavern, and then City.
Okay, so, yeah, Paul's in a pretty good position. He's going to swing for four, take Kyle down to 16. And then Kyle needs to draw a land, I think, and then he can play a Mirren Crusader, which could trade for the Thought Knots here. Ooh, that's not the land he wanted, though. So with this land, he can only cast, like, a Phyrexian Revoker, which is fine. It can hold off the Mimic if Paul doesn't drop any more threats. So I think that's might be what he ends up doing. I don't think he has any other choices. He could try to port Paul, but seems kind of not that useful.
Right. I mean, considering what Paul's board looks like and what his board looks like.
He also has Thalia, so I like that more than Revoker. Forgot about that. Well, Swords of Plowshares doesn't work because of the Chalice.
Right.
He's talking about Sword of Fire and Ice? Yeah, Sword of Fire and Ice is pretty good. He can play it next turn and then equip the turn after, so that seems pretty strong. Paul's going to be looking for, like, a Warping Whale or a Dismember before Kyle can get that online. So Kyle drew another land, so I think he can actually afford to play the sword and then Wasteland Paul here. So that looks like what he's going for. Oh, no, he's just going to play a Revoker. And are we sure he had a Sword of Fire and Ice in his hand?
I don't know, I didn't see it.
I definitely saw Mirran Crusader, Swords of Plowshares, Mother of Runes. The question is the last card. So two of those are completely turned off. Yep, that is a Sword of Fire and Ice. I think that's probably what I would have played.
Actually, Paul has the City of Traitors in his hand, it looks like.
Okay.
So he's not so bad on the lands.
Does he have a Warping Wheel as well? Not sure. Okay, so now Kyle is actually in a decent position.
Yeah, this is nice.
Next turn he has... Oh, wow, Paul actually just scoops him up. Huh. I think he definitely was in trouble. Oh, you know, Kyle could not play the sword after he played the Thalia because it cost 4. So that's why it made sense that he played the Revoker the turn after. But next turn, he could have played Sword. I'm surprised Paul scooped him up right there. I think he was definitely behind that game, but I don't think he was out.
Do you think he's trying to play more quickly since he drew last turn? Or last match? But that was against Miracles, so...
Yeah, I don't know what it was. I think he just figured he was behind, so he was just going to scoop him up, but I'm kind of surprised by that. He did know Kyle's hand, so he knew, like, a sword was incoming. Probably didn't have that many answers. I guess he doesn't have any answers to Crusader. So, yeah, maybe he was almost out of options.
So Bob, when are we gonna see you in any upcoming events anytime soon? You coming out to DC?
So I'm not coming to DC. I think I might come to the Quest for Power at Squabbles, and so I think that's like the 20th. So yeah, only be a few short weeks, my love.
Yeah, I actually need to talk to Caffrey. So we may. I know Anurag wants to. He wants to go up to the 5K. Up at a Tales of Adventure on that Saturday, which is the 19th.
Yeah, so I talked to him about that, and I think when I last spoke, at least, I don't know if he changed his mind again, he was like, he thought it was only 2 hours away. It's actually like three
it's
and
like
a half hours.
Almost, yeah.
Yeah, it's
so
quite far.
I might be down for that if more people are into going.
I maybe.
It's only like a 5K, so I don't know.
I would need like a crew to like hype me up if I'm to cast that entire event and then the next day cast the Quest for Power at Squabbles.
Bob, if you're coming up that weekend, you should just hang out with me.
Yeah, I was thinking like, I don't know, we could just chill on Saturday and then Sunday
we could watch Netflix too and chill.
Netflix and chill, bro.
Yeah, so if you guys haven't heard, Tales of Adventure is doing a 5K. It's a satellite series, so you can actually get buys for Eternal Extravaganza 4, which is going to be later on this year. That is coming up March 19th. That's a Saturday. That next day, the Sunday, is I think it's part 6 for the Legacy Quest for Power series at Squabbles / MTG First. They're going to be in Glenbury, Maryland. So check out both those events if you guys are near either, because both shops are awesome. Both owners are awesome.
Part 6? That went quickly. So when are we going to have the Black Lotus tournament?
I think that's the one we're gonna end on.
Right. I mean, that would be the most reasonable guess.
The next tournament's really good, too, though. It's Mox Sapphire, which is probably,
right,
you know, is the best Mox in... And I think there's like tons of jewel lands too being given out. So if you guys, oh, that's a strong opening. Yeah, so if you guys are in the area, I would definitely consider going and checking out the event. All right, so they're on to game two.
So worth noting, I'd never seen that sequence before where the draw trigger resolves before the exile trigger like that. I've never seen that happen, but
yeah, basically,
that kind of makes sense.
Yeah, basically it happens when like they have a removal spell they want to get rid of the seer with, so they lose their best card because you know Paul gets to see their whole hand, but still worth it. So interesting here, Kyle decides to port instead of Wasteland. And so that allows him to cast a... So I think he's doing that, so then next turn he can cast Mangara with... And then start doing the whole Mangara Caracas chain, but my guess is it's not going to work out too well because Paul has answers in his deck for Mangara, and because it's just very slow, and... You know, even something like a Wasteland could stop it.
Mangara is very interesting. That version of Death and Taxes was not seen for a while.
Yeah, I think people generally don't like it because it's very slow. It's better in metagames where like something like Miracles or the Mirror is really popular. Oh, wow. Paul Lynch is just mono, Sol lands.
I kind of think if you're on Mangara, you cut... You're pretty much a pure control deck at that point. You cut some of your cards that are big beaters but don't really gain you a long-term advantage, like Sarah, Avenger, things like that.
Actually, I don't even know if he's good in the mirror because other players also have Caracas, so... Good against lands, I guess. Alright, so Paul has all the mana he could possibly want. But he does need an answer for the Mangara. Doesn't look like he... Oh, he has Revoker, I think. So he could go Revoker, Mangara, Reality Smasher? I think because he has 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. He should have enough. Yeah, Smasher. Get him for 5, and then Revoker. Kyle has a Mangara of Karondor.
Yeah, Bob, can you tell us a little bit about that card for those that don't know it, the synergy between it and Caracas?
Sure. Yeah, so he has the text up. So how it works is you tap, activate Mangara, and tap is the only cost. Oh, here he's going to do it right now. So he's going to tap. I didn't see him discard a card. Maybe Paul missed the trigger. Alright, sorry, yeah, let me explain Mangara, which is it taps, exiles itself and another target permanent, and in response to that, he's activating Caracas to return Mangara to his hand. And so what that does is the Mangara goes to his hand, then the trigger resolves, and then it tries to exile the Mangara, but it's not no longer on play because it's in your hand, so you get to rerun that loop. Usually that loop is most effective when you have like an Aether Vial out. I think Paul might have missed the Reality Smasher discard trigger. Oh, I guess maybe it's only for spells. It's not for abilities. My bad. Or, yeah, exactly. And so Kyle's at 10. The second Mangara is going to be a little bit too slow, I think. So he needs to figure out some other solution. All right. I guess I lied. It's not going to be too slow, but if Paul has any other follow-ups, it might be. Because next turn, Paul can play another Flicker, or Kyle can play another Flicker Wisp. So he looks like he needs to play Flicker Wisp and then Mongara something. I think he just has to Flicker Wisp the Revoker and Mongara the Smasher. And then he loses his Mongara, but I think that's fine. I think he's at 5 life. He doesn't have too many other options. Interesting, so he decides to just go ahead and pass the turn. So, I'm not really sure what his plan is. So he's chumping the... He can't activate it because of the Phyrexian Revoker. So I guess he just missed that. He forgot about the Revoker. And he can still return it to his hand, so he doesn't take any damage there, so he goes to 1. But I think he's just going to be too slow to do anything now. I think he had to go for the Flicker Wisp, Exile Smasher play last turn. And even then, it's... Yeah. Yep, that's game. On to number 3. Wow, we got a punt counter. That's kind of...
Yeah, we have a punt counter. We also have a wrong counter, but it's for when you guys say something wrong. And so far, you haven't said anything wrong, Bob.
I'm going to accept that and think that I was probably wrong about many things. Yeah, so that's what he did the turn prior, and then... This turn, I think he forgot about the Revoker because he felt like he dealt with it last turn, but that's the play he should have made this past turn. Then he could have probably traded off his Flicker Wisp and Revoker for the Endbringer. So, would have bought him some time. Thanks for the follow, Iperogeny Arcane. Lewis, we usually get quite a few viewers. Believe it or not, we get pretty close to 100, a lot of the events that I've seen at least. Also, yeah, we're not just some randos. We're the Snapcasters. We are, like, the legacy streamer extraordinaires. I think...
Yeah, we got to get you for commentary more, Bob.
I think there definitely is, like, a huge fan base for legacy. I think it started with the SCG circuit. People just really got used to watching it, and now it's so rare that it's just so popular when you get to see it online, especially like a real person event instead of just Moto.
Unfortunately, we've had a couple more channels start popping up. We're going to start working on some cross promotion soon, but we'll let you guys know about any shared events. I was hosting the Magic Card Market stream last night. Another bunch of cool group of guys.
Oh, cool, yeah. I'm trying to think. Yeah, no, they're like the site that like sponsors me, too. They're pretty awesome. What was the event you guys were doing?
Oh, what, that I was hosting? Oh, I meant, like, I was hosting their stream. It was last night. They have a Thursday Night Legacy stream, so shout out.
Oh, I see what you're saying. Yeah, that's cool. Interesting that Paul left an endless one, because it's really vulnerable to Flicker Wisp. I wonder if he's seen that interaction before. My guess is he has, and he doesn't have anything better to bring in.
Sorry guys, I had to stop that for a bit. I was having some technical difficulties with something I'm trying to do, which is create a document. It's amazing that over the years of consumer electronics have come and gone, computers are still impossible to use.
Hey Diana, it's really hard to hear you.
Oh, okay.
Can you hear Bob?
I did not understand what she said.
Yeah, I couldn't.
But her voice sounded nice.
Your voice sounds nice too. Can you hear me?
You sound like you're like 10 feet away from the mic.
She sounds like she's underwater.
What? Maybe I am underwater. Okay, can you hear me now?
It sounds like you're on speakerphone on a cell phone, is what it sounds like.
It's really weird. I don't think I changed anything. Well, from earlier, maybe I can just talk about. Is that good?
Yeah, that's better.
Okay.
Yeah, I'm trying to figure out what's going on over here. So, looks like Paul just went for a spatial contortion on the Stoneforge Mystic that got a Jite. So, Jite costs 3. He's not going to... I don't think he's going to be able to cast it. I wonder if he has a Flicker Wisp in his hand. Yeah, he does. So the Flicker Wisp is really going to punish Paul for the endless one. Got a smasher. So he could try to trade the Thalia and the Flicker Wisp for the smasher, which seems fine. Well, the thing is, like, the Smasher is just so big that, like, you don't have too many options. The Eldrazi Mimic's also a 5-5 right now, so it's kind of, Yep, he went for it, and Paul has a Dismember to punish him.
Kind of damned if you do, damned if you don't.
Yeah. Yeah, so see, now Smasher's just going to get in every single turn, and if Kyle doesn't find a Swords of Plowshares or something to deal with it, he's just going to be dead very quickly. This is the strength of the Eldrazi deck, is it kills you very quickly.
Right, and it presses its advantages. Exceptionally fast for Legacy, or I guess the creature size is exceptionally large for the format.
Wow, he's taking his Vial up to 4. I guess that means he has, like, Wiltleaf Liege, which makes sense. Okay, he found a Swords of Plowshares for the Smasher, so he's definitely not out of the game yet. He will need to discard a card, but it's still definitely a great draw for Kyle. Paul is actually at less life because of the Ancient Tombs. I don't think Kyle's got in for a single attack, but he could, like, just randomly steal the game with a flyer now. All right, so he's exiling the Smasher, discarding the Jite.
So, due to strange circumstances, I have to switch wireless networks, so let me know if this drops me, or I guess I'll know. This might drop me.
Oh, wow, what a sick play.
Confirmed for another punt. Totally should have pitched that to the Endbringer.
Yeah, he should have pitched the Wiltleaf Liege instead of the Jite. That would have been insane. That would have meant he had an extra Jite, but I still feel pretty good about his position right here. Trying to figure out if he's taking an unnecessary risk with the attack. I think the clock is the same both ways, so I think he definitely just swings with one creature. And that creature is the Marin Crusader. I guess the game was going to be too fast-paced for the Jite to matter, but it still would have been a heads-up play by Kyle if he saw that. Alrighty, so it looks like Kyle takes it 2-1, and Paul packs it in with the Eldrazi. This is how I feel about the Eldrazi deck. I think it definitely has some very unbeatable openings, and it does have game against almost every deck in the format, but I feel like it's ultimately inconsistent, and once you stop it, you win.
Who's printing right now?
It's me, sorry.
Can you hear your mic? It's my print.
Okay, well, so, sorry. It's funny that you couldn't hear me earlier when I was actually talking, because I was talking about how I had to leave to print something.
You're, like, kind of loud now. Do you have Skype automatically adjusting your volume?
I don't know. This is Skype on OS X, which is an operating system.
You need to uncheck it. It will automatically adjust the volume of the microphone for you. But I got a BRB, guys. Okay. We're going to look and see if we can get us another match.
Wow, thanks for that.
Hold on, I need to go fix something. I have, like, this light that's flickering above me. It's really bugging me, so I'm going to be right back, too. All right, I'm back. Diana, are you still there? I guess she's fixing something up. And I think we might have a game three going on. I'm eating a Nature Valley protein bar right now. It's so good.
All right, guys, I'm back. All right, so is it cool to have you guys on stream and be the feature match?
Yeah.
Okay, cool. Game three? Okay, what was your name again?
Jimmy.
Jimmy? And what's your last?
Arthur has a
P-E-Y-T-O-N. P-E-Y-T-O-N? Okay. K-Y-O-O?
Yeah,
can you guys hear me chewing?
I hear something rustling. Sounds like a candy bar.
Oh, that's the wrapper, I guess. I'm almost done with my granola bar.
You good, Bob. Yeah, Kyo is the co-owner of this awesome establishment, HQ Games. Yeah, I didn't realize I had the mic unmuted there. It's just loud here in general.
Q quickly ships a 7 back. I have to imagine NickFit is favored in this matchup because counterbalance isn't that good, and Q probably has some pretty good go over the top threats. Although he's only getting to 5 here, so probably in Jimmy's favor now.
So Bob, what would you play if you were to play in the next event? Or what are you thinking of playing in the Quest for Power?
Either Lands or Four Color Delver. So I just think Lands is probably the best deck right now. I don't think I have the practice with it yet, but I'd like to by the time the Quest for Power rolls around. I also just really want to practice lands to learn the ins and outs of the deck, Because I would say I know, like, all the top tier Legacy decks pretty well. Lands is one of the ones that I know the least well. And so I just want to, you know, learn the deck to get good with it. Four color, as in, very similar to what Lewis played to his top eight. I like playing main deck Decay right now when Chalice is so popular. Decay is very, very good against the Eldrazi deck, whereas Lightning Bolt can just be turned off or, like, you know, too small to deal with the Thought Knots here. Decay at least hits Endless One and Mimic and Thorn and Chalice.
Bob, can you answer that question from Zeith?
Yeah, so Nick Fit is... It's funny, the question, what is Nick Fit, has a multitude of answers because there's like a whole bunch of different decks that call themselves Nick Fit. I think the one thing that generally is in common is they all play Veteran Explorer and they all play Cabal Therapy. So they're usually just these mid-rangey, go-over-the-top green decks. There's the Veteran Explorer. That try to ramp up with Veteran Explorer, which, yep, you can read that right there. When it dies, each player gets two basics. So it uses that in conjunction with Cabal Therapy and cards like Phyrexian Tower to ramp their mana and then play like big threats. Like you see a Siege Rhino in his hand, and I know they go way over that as well. So that's Nick Fit. And there's different variants of Nick Fit too. Like there are blue variants. You know, it looks like he's on a every color except for blue variant. There's variants with like Burning Wish and Scapeshift combo. There's versions with Birthing Pod. There's versions with Recurring Nightmare. It's really just like a whole plethora of different green mid-range decks. So I don't know if I agree with that, Lewis. Interesting description. So I don't know if I agree with signing out Explorer. So Explorer does get Swords to Plowshared, but I think most of your threats do already, so I think that's fine. And I think your lands are more powerful than Miracles' lands. If they play multiple entreats, then ramping them is bad, but otherwise, like, you can do a lot more with your mana than they can. Like, most of your threats outclass Jace. Yeah, he does have a Slaughter Games in his hand, so next game, or next turn, it'll be interesting to see if he can cast it and what he names. I think Terminus is a good name. I think you could also go for some of the win conditions, such as, you know, Entreat if you're scared of that, Mentor, Jace, Terminus. Terminus is very frustrating to deal with. It doesn't put the cards in your graveyard, and it's a wrath. If it put the cards in your graveyard, at least, if you're playing something like Delver, you can, you know, delve it away. Alright, looks like he's getting clicked here. Okay, so I was wrong about the Slaughter Games. He had Slaughter Games in a hand that he mulliganed. Interesting what you take here. I think... I think Green Sun Zenith might be the pick. Because the other cards are easily answered by Miracles. Okay, so he's taking the Decay, so perhaps he's trying to land either a counterbalance or a blood moon. I think Q is still at 19, so I'm not sure if he's trying to get there with the click just yet. What's the best Delver deck?
It's like the second time you've been asked this question in this like one event.
The first couple times you were asked, we have like 20 viewers, so there's a lot more.
Yeah, I don't know. Like Lewis said, I like four color. Well, okay, so here's my distinction between four color and Grixis. I think four color, you're running Decay, and Noah wasn't running Decay, so I would call his build Grixis, and I would call Lewis's build four color. It's pretty subtle, but I think that's what I would call it. You could also call the Tarmogoyf decks that run Decay and Lightning Bolt, you could call those four color as well. Yeah. But basically, I like Decay, and I like Pyromancer Therapy. So if you like those cards, you kind of have to play four colors. I could see going Bug as well. I think Bug is better than Rug for sure. And I think I like it more than Grixis too. I think I like Bug more than Grixis. But I think I like four color more than Bug. Yeah, well, in my opinion, that's like my classification for the deck. I don't like Stifle right now. I've always hated Stifle, so it's not really a right now thing. But particularly, I think it's bad because Eldrazi is one of the most popular decks, and it's very bad against Eldrazi. I've seen some Grixis control lists either relying on Painful Truths or Skeletal Scrying. I don't think Noah was running Decay. He definitely wasn't running it main. I don't think he had it in the board either. I think the only green spell he had was Flashback Ancient Grudge. Could his list kill Counterbalance? He had Pyroblast. I don't know if he had... I don't remember if he had Decay in the board. So, back to the game at hand, it looks like Q was able to resolve a Green Sun, get a Veteran Explorer to ramp himself and Flashback Therapy. So he's basically trying to rip apart Jimmy's hand, set himself up to win with any big top deck. Or maybe not win, but, you know, get into a favorable position.
Do you think...
Okay, I mean, Pyroblast technically kills Counterbalance. Sorry, go ahead, Diana.
Oh, I was going to ask if you thought they were even right now, because it doesn't really look like...
I think Jimmy's
like...
way ahead because cards. Yeah.
That's what I would have thought as well.
Yeah. How do you feel about Nykfit, Diana?
How do I feel about it? That's a very broad question.
Just like what feelings does it evoke?
Feelings? Well, so don't go spreading this around, but I do have a soft spot for grindy,
wow,
recursive decks.
You know. So this is just like MTG confessional, like,
yes,
you confess about mud, and you're confessing about
air out
grindy
there,
decks.
Yes.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm going to be, like, very public in saying that, oh, gosh, these grindy green-black decks just, ugh, they're too mid-rangey for me, and they don't have enough brainstorm. But actually, I really do like the aspect of the deck that allows you to get value from sacrificing creatures. Mm-hmm. That's not that much of a secret that I'm a black mage at heart, so yeah, I definitely appreciate decks that run Cabal Therapy, decks that run, you know, Recurring Nightmare.
Mm-hmm. So I remember how we were just saying how like we felt like Kyo was pretty behind. Now he's still behind, but he's only behind like a couple creatures, which isn't so bad. I guess the top matters a lot as well. But he was able to play a Pernicious Deed, which drew a Force of Will to put Jimmy down on cards. Well, that's a great draw. It should, you know, swing the race and force Jimmy to have an answer. Looks like he found Terminus. I couldn't see the other two cards. He's going to go ahead and shuffle that away. So the Rhino is actually kind of lethal in a couple turns. And I like the interaction behind Rhino and Jace, because the Jace can keep ticking down all at once. You're still going to be getting in with the Rhino in some shape or form. Looks like he found Council's Judgment, if I'm not mistaken. I think recognizing magic cards by seeing only a small piece of them is a critical skill when it comes to commentating. I might also be completely wrong. Yeah, until we get those handy-dandy hand cams.
Right.
Oh, it's probably not a Council Judgment because he's topping now, so it might be like, it might be a Terminus. I don't know. No, he drew it. It's a Mentor, maybe? Mentor's the only card I can think of. Yep, it's a Mentor. That he would do things in that order.
Oh, okay, yeah. Even I can see a Mentor. I have this window very small on my screen. So I'm playing an even harder game of identifying a sliver of the card on the tiny screen.
Did you guys see the Shardless Bug question? Oh, Boogie was just curious what, how well positioned it is currently.
Shardless Bug?
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't know. What do you think, Corey/Diana?
Corey/Diana?
Sorry, just one of you.
I think Bug decks should be well positioned, but I will let Corey chime in with his opinion now. Hello? Earth to Corey.
Sorry, you got some admin stuff going on here. I totally missed what was being asked of me.
Sorry, there was a bee on me. Could you repeat what you said?
Oh, so I totally was plugging that channel earlier today to some,
oh, really?
Some of my coworkers, yeah.
That's awesome.
Oh, so disgusting that Miracles gets this card called Monastery Mentor that is like just a good card by itself, and it's letting him out mid-range the grindy mid-range deck, and all he needed was like a top, a brainstorm, and a mentor.
I actually tried Mentor Miracles, and it was so awkward to play. It was just, like, always very difficult to decide when to run the Mentor out and when to go for the more controlling plan.
Mm-hmm.
Do you have any experience playing that deck?
So I never played the Mentor Miracles build. I think that build, you know, won a GP, and I think when I think of that build, I think that they often run, like, Dazes and things like that. So it's just, like, weird because you're playing all these cards that are good with Mentor, but then, like, if you're playing for the late game, they're horrible for the late game.
Right. That's what I found difficult about it. Like, yeah. Maybe the correct way or the correct pilot for that deck would know how to optimally balance those strategies.
Yeah, I think what people do now mostly is they play Mentor as a like win condition that's a little bit less clunky than Entreat, and they often play him in the board.
Right. That's a little bit more common, yeah, than the other build.
Yeah, and so when you're playing him like a extra win condition, like in some matchups, like, you know, maybe like a combo matchup or a matchup like Mud where you want to win quickly, then you jam Mentor on turn three. But in other matchups where you're the control role, you actually just hold him back until the board's clear, and then you jam him.
Mm-hmm.
So that's like three, like each Mentor got +2/+2, just like giving Q the bidness, and he's dead if he doesn't draw anything right here. Oh, slow look. It doesn't quite look like he's slamming it, so. Well, it looks like Jimmy's doing some funky funk. And then he's going to actually click Q. He's going to let Q keep that, and looks like that's the game.
I'm going to go prep for next round. I'll be right back.
Cool. Wow. Q had a lot of hate. He had like two chokes, a slaughter games. I don't like Surgical in this matchup.
Do you think he really needed all those cards?
Wow. Wow. Slaughter games too?
Like, did you see what he took out?
We'll see. But yeah, like, that's definitely a problem if you dilute your own deck too much by bringing in hate. Particularly for cards like Surgical that aren't like one-hit KOs or anything. Like, it looks like he took out Gaddock Teague, which is a threat that's pretty good against Miracles.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah, my guess is, I think Corey mentioned Q owned the store, so I don't know how much actual Legacy he gets to play. But I definitely would not board out Teague or Colligan's Command.
Yeah, those seem very, well, Culligan's Command seems like a very good offensive strategy, and Teague seems like a very good defensive strategy.
Yeah,
so
the nice thing about Culligan's Command is, like, if the Miracles player goes hellbent and tries to trigger Miracles, mm-hmm. you can actually make them discard the Miracle in response to the Miracle trigger.
Right.
And it's also just, like, a generic 2-for-1, which is pretty good. All right, here's a question for you, Diana.
Mm-hmm.
So I think in general, the correct commentator etiquette is not to, like, criticize the player. But then, like, sometimes it's obvious, like, you know, if he does something wrong. And, like,
sometimes it's obvious they didn't know what they were doing.
Yeah, but I mean, that's honestly, like, the truth. But, like, you know, it's never good to watch a commentator. You know, like, I've seen Owen turn while commentating. He's fantastic Magic player, but he really just, like, rags on the players whenever they make a mistake, and that's not really enjoyable to watch.
Mm-hmm.
I think, like, in general, people like being explained, like, oh, here's the right play, or whatever, but they don't like it when you're just, like, you know, being mean. So I think there's, like, a pretty fine line for, like, what you should and shouldn't say as a commentator regarding misplays, and I'm still trying to figure that out.
So was there a question in there? Because you were like, here's a question.
I don't know, I just want to get your opinion on the matter.
Well, I'd have to agree. I mean, that seems like a pretty straightforward concept, right? Like, people don't like to hear commentators being harsh or unpleasant. But I think the better commentators that I enjoy personally will kind of put it delicately, you know? They'll be like, oh, I don't know about that, like, hey, what was your thought on that? Or what would you have done? That kind of thing. So I think it's fine to point out plays that you disagree with. Obviously, don't say it in a manner that's like, that was bad. This is a bad player. Yeah.
Right. Yeah, I think I agree with that. Yeah, you don't want to, like, discredit the player. Also, just, like, not everybody gets the chance to, like, you know, play thousands of games of Legacy or whatever. We're watching High Tide now. I'm going to go into a whole another rant.
Uh-oh.
They're the only XOs right now, I think. Actually, I think there's one more XO, but we already had them featured.
So I've never,
Ryan hasn't been on camera yet, so...
Oh, no worries. I'm just complaining to complain. Yeah, I don't actually know too much about this matchup. I imagine Chalice is insane and forces Brian to find, like, a cunning wish for some sort of bounce spell in order to win. So, trying to think what else might be good. So, the mana denial plan is going to be no good because Brian just has a bunch of islands in his deck. It's an interesting matchup. Liliana's going to be good. Looks like Dale is actually playing the combo, and I see a Dark Depths in his hand. Well, like, that's the great thing about Legacy is, like, there are so many random decks, and I think especially in the Magic Online leagues right now, there's so many random decks, and I just, it's more fun than it has been in some time, because I felt like the meta was pretty stagnant for a while.
Thinking about getting into Legacy Online.
What realm card are you talking about, MC Fox? Like, realm? Like, what is realm? Corey, do you know what realm is? Is it like... There's some creature that makes... You know the card he's talking about? It's like, does High Tide have any realms?
Realm. Oh, wait. Maybe I was thinking of Rushing River. Oh, it's a fairy's realm. Yeah. Oh, sorry, I can't be saying these words on the
radio. Oh, yeah, Teferi's Realm, that card, obviously. Jeez, can't believe I forgot about Teferi's Realm. What the hell is Teferi's Realm? I'm reading the card, I don't understand it. What is happening with that card? Why would they play that card? What does it do? What's happening? What? I know Legacy, but I don't know that card. What's going on? Diana,
I've seen
help
that
me.
Card before. I don't think it's a High Tide staple or anything.
Okay, so what is the reason to play that card? All right, Dale has a pretty ideal opening. The turn one Bob is good against any deck, but, like, especially a combo deck.
Right.
Brian might be forced to use his force right here, otherwise he's just going to be pitching cards to Liliana, and then the force won't be usable anyways. Oh, no, he actually lets it resolve, which... is fine, but then I would probably have pitched the force. Because now, I just don't know if he's going to have enough resources to go off if he has to lose two more cards and discard another card, you know? Yeah.
Right. I mean, High Tide plays a long game, but he also is facing down pressure on the board, so it's not like, you know, it's not like he can really take his time forever to build his hand back up.
Mm-hmm. Well, I just think, like, it gets to a point where Liliana, like, makes it so that you're going to have maximum, you know, like, two cards in your hand. And if those cards are, like, Force of Will and a blue card, like, yeah. But who knows, maybe he can combo off with only a couple cards, and he was just saving the Force for, like, a Chalice.
There's Merchant Scroll. Giving High Tide. What's your favorite High Tide art?
I told you I despise that deck, so I just try not to look at anything.
You just, like, even refuse to answer that question. That's how much you hate it.
Well, I'm also not, like, an art person.
Are you really not? Do you have no preference?
Like,
I bet you probably don't even have any artwork in your home at all. Oh, wait, that's right. You have a painting. Whoops.
See? I don't really, like...
What's that
I don't
painting
appreciate
of?
Art the same way a lot of people do, is all I'm saying. Like, the painting is actually still sitting in the original, like, cardboard box that it came in.
I'll buy it off you.
Yeah, you got, you got 10K. I'll do it for 10K.
What the heck? Is that how much it's worth? Like,
I don't think it's worth 10K, but it is.
It could at least go for 6 to 7, at least, I think.
So you're saying there's somebody out there that would pay $6,000 to $7,000 for that, to get that thing. Wow.
I think that's within the realm of possibility, which is why it's kind of absurd. I got
right?
So lucky.
It does boggle the mind.
Yeah, I still don't know what I'm going to do, though. I'm very lucky that I have a day job and don't really need to sell it at this point. I am definitely considering selling that along with the rest of my collection, you know, if I have some big expenses like, you know, getting married or buying a house or something. But for now, I'm just going to hold on to it.
Ooh, thank you, everybody in chat, chiming in with your high tide preferences.
All right, he's just going for a time spiral. So I guess really for high tide, you technically only need 2 cards, the combo. You need 1 high tide and 1 time spiral. So maybe the Liliana wasn't quite as bad for Ryan as I thought it might be.
Time spiral is very powerful. It does does give you all of that time back, huh? Hence the name of the card.
Yeah.
Right.
So I was talking about... So I won Legacy Champs, and with that I won the original painting, like the physical painting itself for Tundra, which was commissioned by Wizards of the Coast.
The new
but
Tundra,
not the very first Tundra, but like a new Tundra that they haven't released yet, but they might release on like Magic Online or something. All right, I think Brian's got this game. I know traditionally junk decks have been very good matchups for High Tide. I think Dale's deck's a little bit better because it has Chalice, but even Chalice isn't that big of a problem because you can always Cunning Wish for an answer. I'm going to... I don't know. Have you ever played High Tide before, Diana?
Have I ever piloted it?
Yeah.
I piloted Solidarity. Does that count?
I'll count
High
that.
Tide? All right.
Yeah, I'll count that. Do you want to explain sort of the in general what Ryan's going to be doing for the next 20 minutes and how he's going to win?
Okay, so obviously High Tide lets his islands make an extra blue mana. So he has a bunch of cards in his deck that do a couple of things. They'll help him draw more cards and also untap his lands and other permanents. So basically, he's going to be able to untap his lands, net mana each time, and draw additional cards to continue repeating that process. And then he can finish any number of ways. He can, cast a really big Blue Sun Zenith, having his opponent empty his library. He can Brain Freeze, which is a Storm card that mills out his opponent. But basically, once you have an insane amount of mana and cards, you can do anything you want. Is that kind of an explanation that would make sense to someone who hasn't seen the deck before?
I think so. Made sense to me. Brain Freeze and like Blue Sun Zenith are the two common kill conditions. Looks like he's counting. Is it the mana or the storm? It's the mana, I think, right?
That looks like mana to me, and the other die is the tide counter.
Yep. Yeah, it's probably he's going for this. Blue Sun Zenith. What is Legacy Champs? So Legacy Champs is a annual tournament. Currently it's in Philly, and it's run by Card Titan, and it's actually a Wizards official event. So it's not quite a GP, but last year there were quite a few players. I think there were about 750 players for the Legacy Championship and about 450 for the Vintage Championship. Yeah, it's the Legacy event at Eternal Weekend.
The two events together are called Eternal Weekend. It's one of the rare occasions where you see Legacy and Vintage sanctioned together and officially sponsored by Wizards of the Coast.
Yeah, I think it's actually the only official Wizards event for Vintage.
And wasn't it ran at Gen Con for a while until it got, like, too big?
Yeah, exactly. It used to be a Gen Con thing. All right, so, now you see Brian has, like, all the mana he could possibly want. Almost. You're going to say something, Diana?
Oh, I was just going to encourage anyone who's interested in Eternal Magic, who's, you know, anywhere in the area to check it out because it's the biggest event of its kind. I mean, it's the only event of its kind, if you're talking about, like, exactly what it does.
Okay, so it looks like he's Flusterstorming his own Cunning Wish.
And then
Flusterstorming his Flusterstorm.
He's gonna Flusterstorm each Flusterstorm and refuse to pay for his second Flusterstorm and resolve Cunning Wish.
Yeah, and then finally gets the Brain Freeze.
There you have it, ladies and gentlemen. High tide.
So I think Brian did a pretty good job of playing quickly. It's like the slow high tide players that I want to rip my face off.
Oh, Bob, if we ever do a Secret Santa event, I know what deck to give you.
Okay, I feel like if I play it, it's not as going to be as bad. I just hate sitting there.
I hate it when other people play. It's Bob Huang, guys.
Exactly.
Ladies and gentlemen, Bob Huang, 2016.
I kind of want to get a Secret Santa event together now. Just and make sure you can go. And then I'm just going to wait to find out what excuse you use to not show up. So are you crashing at my place, Bob, for the... Are you coming up for the Legacy Power thing? Quest for Power?
I haven't decided yet, but if I do, I would like to crash. That's okay.
Bo show, son. You always have a spot here next to me in bed. I mean, Tights. On the couch.
Next to you on the couch.
The power couch.
I'm also like slightly upset you got a new couch. Your new couch is way nicer.
But
I had some good times on that old one.
So I'm gonna go on the record and say that new couch, best couch. Strictly better than old couch. So the couch, you would have loved the couch we had before the fire because it was my brother and mine that we found in the dumpster when we were in college because we were super broke. However, that couch, we nicknamed it Nap Time because it was the most comfortable couch ever. When we sat on it, it was nap time.
You know, Bob, I know you and I met up at Corey's house once before the fire. Do you remember anything about the house? Because I don't. I remember I met Jason that day and that's it.
Free fire? Yeah, that's a great point. I'm definitely have been there before the fire, but I don't remember.
I know you and I met up there to go to Philly. So we were carpooling with Corey.
Oh my God, Belazen's got a good point. That was pretty good.
I don't know what he's talking about.
Eh, Drunk Bob is okay, but tell me about Neeraj.
Shout out to Neeraj. That man is awesome.
I call Drunk Neeraj Beeraj.
It's pretty perfect.
So the card he was using with Caracas was Mangara of Korondor.
What?
Yeah, there's
right.
Four Mangaras, Diana. Come on, be specific.
Oh, come on!
Haven't you learned from Pithing Needlegate?
I didn't learn Bob's lesson.
10 out of 10. 10 out of 10.
You know, there is no card named Mangara. The only other one we could think of was Rootwalla. Because Rootwalla is exactly the name of a card, and it's also a substring in another card name.
Shackles. Shackles and Vedalken Shackles.
That one too. Did you obsessively find out all the other examples?
No, that was just one that actually did happen at, like, apparently happened at Pro Tours back in the day.
Yeah, gotcha.
So I did hear about that. Pursuit of Knowledge. If you draw a card, you're just the counter inside room 3 study cards. That's cool.
How does that beat Brain Freeze?
Oh, Nicole Bolas. That's a great example of another card. There's the dragon Nicole Bolas, and then the Nicole Bolas Vinswalker.
Is the only other... there's also Venser. Venser's one.
No, there's...
Well, okay, I think there are a lot of cards with, like two names, but then it has to be a card with... The exact
Wait,
name is like the word.
There's no cards.
So like Borborygmos, Shackles, yeah. There are a lot of cards that like with two words that share one of the words. But there
right.
are fewer with like just one word and then the word happens to represent another card colloquially. Looks like Dale's down to 6. He has a Chalice and a Thoughtseize, so I got and a Bob, so pretty good start for him. I'm gonna go turn 1 Thoughtseize into turn 2 Chalice or Bob. So scrying in Legacy is definitely way better when you're on the draw, because then you'll definitely get to use your scry. If you're on the play, you oftentimes just have to fetch it away. Yeah, so my guess is that... they often leave one in the board to Cunning Wish 4. So maybe that's how you lost that game. Oh, he did not. That gets way more interesting. Did he have, like, Palancron beatdown or something? Like
Palancron, I love it. I would love to see a High Tide Palancron deck.
he comboed out without a high tide. Is that... Are you being serious? Like, he just, like, hard comboed out with, like, a bunch of, like, time spirals and building storm?
That is possible. It's very difficult.
It seems insane because none of your cards are getting mana.
Here's the thing. It's much more doable if you don't need to achieve a high storm count. You know what I mean?
Yeah, but you can't actually cast that many spells because
that's what I mean. That's gonna be your limitation because you're gonna run out of mana. So if your storm count that you need to achieve is pretty low, then it's more doable.
I'm actually gonna go look up the price of Palancron right now because I'm curious.
It is
$17 TCG low.
I did not know that there was more than one printing of Palancron. Is that what that means, or?
Wow. Dale's really putting the screws on this game. He's just, like, dropping lock piece after lock piece, which makes sense because he has a Bob. Go Bob. Oh, man, this is great. I'm actually lying down now.
Corey, when are we getting a webcam for Bob?
I would love a Bob cam.
Bob cam?
Yep. I'm actually working on getting stuff built into the graphics, so if we want to show our faces, we can. Like, all you guys would need to do is just turn on your webcams.
True story, I don't have a face.
Well, I'm still working on the graphics, so...
Like, I did before the Skeleton War. Welcome to Legacy, ladies and gentlemen. Check out this board here.
What he gets for this situation. He needs to kill the chalice and he needs to kill the Canada, so rebuild's a great way to do both in one. Oh man, if Ryan wins this game, I will have to begrudgingly admit that that's pretty sweet. I think he's gotta go for an end step rebuild. Dale missing the critical line of ticking down Dark Depths by one counter. Definitely going to lose this game now.
I chuckled, but, you know, it's something you should pay attention to.
Ooh, Slaughter Games. Yeah, I mean, definitely name High Tide here, and then you straight can't lose unless Brian had a High Tide in the sideboard.
Yep.
So, if you name Cunning Wish. Yeah, but he has a rebuild in his hand.
I think High Tide has to be the priority, even though Cunning Wish is very powerful.
He could name Rebuild if Brian doesn't cast it. I mean, Rebuild's... that's what he went for, actually. So I think Brian knew if he named High Tide, he was out of outs, because he probably doesn't have a Cutting Wish in the board. But Dale didn't necessarily know that, so he named Rebuild, and now Brian, he's not out of outs. He could Cutting Wish for another artifact bounce spell. I don't know if he has another one that bounces both the Canonist and the Chalice, though. And he's going to need to get rid of both.
Right. Well, then. Now we see what
he's
happens.
It looks like he has a Hurgle's Recall in his deck. Snap, okay. That answers one of them.
All right.
So, Diane, are you planning on playing in any upcoming events? I'm guessing she's AFK.
Yeah. I don't think. Is Brian playing Candelabra?
I'm not sure.
Candelabra.
I know he wasn't in Dig Days.
That's one of the few legacy cards that I don't have.
Yeah, I don't have those either.
I think Jeff has like a playset, so if I ever need him, call him. If favor.
I know that or the Hatfields, right? They probably got a.
Yep,
Hatfields. they might have one or two.
One or two playsets or two.
Considering they're the reason why they're so gosh darn expensive.
Yeah, well, don't forget those 12 post players.
Yeah, I think 12 post uses it the best right now.
Yeah. Yeah, it's funny because it's just like, it's also on the reserve list and it's such a niche card.
Yeah, when they were announcing the Magus's, I heard Magus of Taunos, I was like, oh my god, yes, this is going to be so good. And the card's horrible.
Wait, did it have the same ability?
Yes.
Oh, it just cost too much? It sounds like a bar fight over there, Corey.
Is it Magus of... Yeah, I mean...
Magus of the Candelabra.
Oh, yeah, that's the one. Hey, welcome back. Yeah, because it has to tap. And
well, so does Candelabra.
Yeah, actually, they have the same activated ability.
Yeah. It's so close to being good.
So, does this place, do they have like a regular FNM too? Like, are they running like standard and draft concurrently, or is it just Legacy?
It's Legacy on Fridays. To give you an idea, I don't think they're FNM Fires. But they host Force of Will. They have a big event here, so there's a lot of people playing Force of Will. And there's a lot of people playing Smash Bros. Too. They got a TV set up in the back.
Nice. Yeah, that's awesome. I wish we had a store that like just did Legacy on Fridays. All of ours are just like standard and limited.
The Baltimore community is really big in a Legacy. So like this is like their shop. Like other people go to other shops to play FNM. This is where they go to play Legacy on Fridays.
Yeah, that's awesome. Like Dale's opening on a ley line. My guess is that card's not very good against High Tide. It does a little bit, meaning when you time spiral, you don't draw extra High Tides over. But Dale possibly just didn't have any good cards to bring in at all. So
yeah, it seems like a strange choice, but. It might be just better than something else.
Chalice is a good one.
Alright. So Brian finds the Force.
Everything's actually supposed to be exiled.
He's, I think he's catching that now. Yep.
He's looking for a Teague.
Teague.
Alright, so Brian's going to go for the end step Cunning Wish, possibly for Snap. Brian has like snap, land, time spiral. He could actually just win.
That would be.
Or I see he needs high tide too. But I'm just saying, it's kind of crazy.
He needs to net mana from snapping.
Well, no, it's mana neutral.
Well, that's what I mean. Like, he needs to net mana from an untapped spell. Like, your initial situation didn't have the high tide in it.
Yeah. Oh my goodness, we have one more round after this.
I know, right?
Grandfather. I'm like falling asleep right now.
If you guys want to bail at any time, you don't have to stay for all four rounds. We can probably pull some.
Oh, it depends. Are you going to get something spicy on? Something hot to wake me up?
I can see who's doing well and figure that out.
You heard it. Something hot. Burn versus burn.
Well, so it's going to be one of these guys, and then...
Well, it doesn't have to be. I can just see what's, like, paired up.
It's cooking.
Excuse me. I can just see what's paired up and pick something. Gosh, I can't talk right now.
The other thing with playing High Tide is I feel like you have all the fun because you are doing all the thinking and you're doing all the cantripping and all the tutoring.
You can say the same about Miracles.
To the attraction of playing these types of decks. They're like my complete kryptonite. I only play these decks because you just dirt all around and have fun.
So Dale really had like three hate permanents this game, and my guess is it's just not going to matter. Yeah, the Chalice, which is Forest, the Gaddock Teague, and...
Here goes first high tide.
Yep, the Snap's going to net him a mana.
I think the first high tide is always the most exciting one. The one that gives you that feeling in the pants.
There you go. Dale's not... Oh, no, wait, he didn't scoop. Never mind. I thought he was just, like, done.
Picking
bullshit.
It all up. Everything.
No, he's gonna let Brian roll the dice.
It's just like, you know what? I refuse to play along with you comboing off.
Fizzle. 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 Yeah, oh my gosh, the one thing that could possibly be worse than Miracles dominating everything would be High Tide dominating everything. I would eat my face.
You would eat your face?
I would do unspeakable things. I saw Feline in Philly. I wonder if she's still on High Tide. I don't think she did well, so she probably is. Oh, you don't think she played? Okay.
Wait, did she not play, or was she on Miracles? Or she didn't play High Tide. But confused.
Yeah, I don't know. Do you know, interesting. I was going to ask, like, do you know, like, kind of the sequencing for High Tide? Like, when you're supposed to cast your meditates and, I guess you always want to cast your High Tides ASAP, and then you're trying to net as much mana as possible, and then see as many cards as possible.
Yes, Bob. Yes,
yeah,
mana and cards are good. You want as many of those as possible. You're right.
I don't know. I'm tired.
I'm tired, too. Don't worry about it. So the sequencing...
How many cores of portals have been played today? I'm going to go ahead and say zero. That's the one bad financial decision I've made recently. And actually, I still don't really think it's that bad. I spent like $100 buying up Chorus of Portals, and to me, I still think the card has lots of potential to just go up.
I still feel that way about Aurelia's Fury, but guess what? Guess what?
What?
It's not that good. It's not that good. You heard it here first, ladies and gentlemen.
Yeah, I don't know. I think Legacy, it might not be quite there, but I think it could be played in Vintage, too. It's like turn one portal from shops is just like the sickness.
All right, without peeking, what are the names of the options on Coercive Portal? Oh no, somebody posted it, man.
You're gonna do another poll? Are you poll crazy?
I was going to, but now everyone has probably already seen it.
Yes, I think with this deck you need to figure out like when you want High Tides and when you just need draw spells. I think usually you just want two tides and then you're good. So he actually potentially boarded out a High Tide because he saw Slaughter Games.
The red dice is the extra turn count.
And the white dice is the cat count. I like it. Poll. Does Diana need a poll intervention?
Oh my god. So they're counting the number. Okay, this is hilarious. Apparently Meditate has cats on the artwork, and they're counting the number of cats for the number of extra turns. So there's going to be two cats to every one extra turn.
Oh wow, you should, Corey, you should invest in a feature where you can like bring the card up and so we could see the art. That would be really cool.
Oh yeah, I am planning to work on that this weekend actually. I got a lot of cool visual stuff in the work. We're gonna have animations, so whenever we pull that card up, it's gonna like
look
really
cool and
slide in. Oh my gosh!
Have you ever watched like a Japanese stream? There's just like random Pikachus and like animations going across the stream. I don't know. It's kind of crazy.
Yeah, we should have some random animations. I felt like you would choose that one.
Oh, well, you know what I would choose? Hold on. Oh, you beat me to it. Not fair. I did the full URL. You did. You'd like. Ah.
Wait, what poll is this? Did we actually have a poll?
Of course we had a poll. Why would there not be a poll?
There was one nope and no no.
Okay, I missed that whole thing and I don't think I missed
anything. I'm gonna reenact the AVI.
Whoop.
Nope. Whoop.
Nope.
If you if you pull up the YouTube video and I think it's if you smash six, it just keeps going whoop 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 whoop.
I think it was like the first thing you made me watch when I first met you. Like the
fun fact, it's the single most popular Team Fortress 2 video on the internet.
So I like that Brain Freeze is the kill because I think it's a little bit faster than Blue Sun Zenith.
It is much faster, but Blue Sun Zenith is kind of more of a sure thing.
Yeah, that's true. You don't know what assholes put Emrakul on their sideboards.
Hey, that deck, Donnie, we can't be talking about that deck on stream. That stuff's still in the lab, yo.
Is it? I think it's ready to go.
It's almost. I'd like to change it. So shout out to Rory. He's made some pretty cool changes to the deck. I've been too busy working on Tortured Existence because I think that deck is like legit the next best deck in Pauper. I think it's going to just actually crush it. I'm actually, no joke, I'm about to get an MTGO account just so I can play that deck and crush online.
Nice.
RVA Legacy, thanks for the follow. Yeah, Bub, do you play Pauper at all?
No.
You, like, legit should. Like, it's an amazing
legit,
format.
Legit, like, legit, bro.
Dude, so, bro.
Dude, damn, bro.
You should totally check it out.
It actually is really fun.
It's also a great Brewers format, too, man. You can play, like, whatever you want.
It has just the right balance, I think, between having powerful cards and kind of having a kitchen table flavor. Like, I think it's really easy on the palate, like a smooth wine.
Nice.
It's supposed to be a tongue-in-cheek comparison.
Okay, looks like next round's going up, so BRB.
BRB, bro. Like, legit BRB.
Oh my goodness.
Oh
yes. They just released the trailer to Finding Dory.
There was a trailer that was out.
I think that was like a teaser trailer. I think this one's like a full trailer.
Full trailer. That's awesome. I'll go check it out right now, in fact.
Yeah, I guess we could do it while we're chilling. Oh man, I'm gonna watch it right now.
Yeah, the last one I was out was like a teaser that was on the Ellen DeGeneres show.
Uh-huh. Ugh, that was really annoying. It was just playing and then I clicked something and it went away. Alright, it's back.
Oh, this one's also from the Ellen show. Should I watch this or should I watch 18 Photoshop fails you have to see? I'm just looking at my YouTube front page.
All right, who wants to explain what Cheerios is?
I honestly think that's your job, Corey.
Yes.
Seems like something that you would just love to do.
I have brewed several forks of Cheerios, two in fact. It's really interesting. Yeah, so I can tell you all about Cheerios. The idea is you're playing all zero-drop creatures. Yes, zero-drop creatures. There are lots of them, actually. And in fact, over half our deck is going to be zero-drop creatures. And we're going to play Glimpse of Nature probably on turn one. So the idea is you will... No, Forks is in... All right, that was actually pretty good. So the idea is you play a card, draw a card, play a card, draw a card. So the idea being you do this until you get to exile three Seeming Spirit Guides or Elvish Spirit Guides, whichever. And then you're going to play Beastmaster's Ascension, which is an enchantment that says whenever you attack with a creature, put a quest counter on it for each creature. And when it has, like, I think 7 or more, or 5 or more, all your creatures get +7/+7. Or +5/+5. Yeah, that's right. So the idea is you just do one big dumb alpha strike and hit for, like, I don't know, something in the 20s or 30s. But there's lots of different builds for it. There's one that involved, like, playing Chalice of the Void on 0 in Multani's presence. But anyway, we got a game going up. I can talk about this later.
I just finished the trailer. It was awesome.
Yes. I love it.
What trailer?
Finding Dory. Weren't you paying attention?
I was doing the setting up the feature map. Sorry.
Clearly not. Something was more important than finding Dory. I wonder what it was. Anyway, it's really charming. You should watch the trailer. I think you'd like it.
Alrighty, so getting started. Dale was able to have a Punishing Fire right there for Young Pyromancer. And now he's going to try to follow up with one of his own threats.
Oh boy. Yep, ready to go.
Ooh, so that's nice. He has Punishing Fire active. Although Jason does have, it looks like a Wasteland.
Yeah, it takes a little bit to really get
that.
Oh,
wow. He's already ramping up 4 mana. So he's getting a knight. Okay, that makes sense. So I think it was pretty clear that Jason didn't have daze because he would have dazed the Punishing Fire. So I like going for the knight, being aggressive here. Wow. Yeah, he's just double bolting the knight because the knight means business. All right, now Dale's down to 2 removal spells. So Jason also lost a 2-for-1.
You didn't actually laugh, Diana. I was listening.
I typed, ha ha ha, that should be good enough for you, okay.
Capital large. God, I'm so fucking stupid.
So I didn't, you know what, I didn't type LOL and not laugh out loud.
Interesting. So Jason's going for an island before pondering? Because I don't think I saw ponder. Maybe he has a true name nemesis. Oh, he's a Snapcaster Mage, so that makes sense. I guess.
Okay, Snapcaster. Just to get the Snapcaster.
Snapcaster to Lava Spike. Okay, so that was end step. Gotcha. Makes more sense now.
Yeah, everything is coming together. Now there's the ponder. What's the play, Corey? You call it. What would you have done? Just not play a land?
So the advantage of holding it in your hand is you can brainstorm it away.
Mm-hmm.
Or you can potentially even surprise them if they play a land that is really important. So like a Thespian Stage or another Grove.
I totally agree. I just wanted somebody to say it. Corey, you should have one of those old-timey car horn sounds, like ooga.
I just spit out a little bit when you said that. That was, that's such a great idea.
Wow, so he's got a chalice on one and two out. So that means his deck, he has some, he has like threes, whereas Jason has very few ways. Dale has a ton of twos in his deck too, though, so.
He does, but this is very difficult for Jason to get out from under. As,
yeah,
I mean
he literally.
The Miracles lock earlier.
Mm-hmm.
Earlier tonight.
Yeah, he literally only has a few threes, so it's. It's pretty tough.
Perfectly
for him.
Fine for Dale.
I think he does want to save some blue cards. So then he can force the will, but yeah, we'll see. I think Jason just has a Dak Vaden and a TNN, so yeah. He could ultimate Dak Vaden.
And do nothing.
No, he could ultimate Dak Vaden and then start bolting.
What? No.
No, and then he bolts like a Knight of the Reliquary and steals it.
Okay. Okay.
Yeah, I mean, it's not likely to work, but it can work. I think the more likely win is just finding his True Name Nemesis.
I mean, Dak can help him find True Name Nemesis.
Agreed. Yeah, the weird thing about Ely's list, he was playing just like one Dak Vaden, which is, it gives some consistency, but it's just not a card that does very much in Legacy. Alright, looks like he's going for another Knight. See if this one sticks.
Why? It's getting so late. I've been drinking coffee all night, but then I started spiking the coffee, and now I think the booze is making me sleepy.
What did you spike it with?
I have this cinnamon Baileys. It's pretty tasty.
Nice. Hot chocolate Baileys. That brings me back. Alright, Dale's just getting the beats on with his, I'm not sure how big his knight is, it's at least like, alright, looks like it was a 6-6. So Jason's dead next turn.
Yeah, that's a lot of power to face down. Well, okay, sure, just to add insult to injury. Like, I still had all these.
So what's the over under on Bob being asleep right now?
The over under?
Oh my god, he's not responding. Is he actually asleep?
No, I'm not asleep, asshole.
Hey, you know what? We have traveled with you so much.
Dude,
where you're in the back seat and just
I will
like,
be blasting some music and
become silent.
I'll look in the like rearview mirror and just see you like leaning back.
I think Bob can sleep anywhere, especially in the car. It's just incredible.
Oh, dude, you should have seen how cute he was when we were driving back from Philly. And I could see him in the rearview mirror, and his head would like slowly droop down, and then like we'd hit a bump or something, and his head would pop back up. It was
so cute.
So you don't even know like how sad I was to miss that open because, like, the
dude, it was a lot of fun.
Yeah, thanks. I couldn't make it, but the Legacy Open in Philly, like, I don't know, 2 or 3 years ago was my first Legacy Open ever, so.
Special place.
And I haven't missed a Philly Open since then until now.
It was up to par for the Philly trips. It was awesome seeing Lewis take a top four. I was really hoping he'd take it down, but unfortunately couldn't piece it together against Eldrazi. Also, I remember waking up in the hotel that we were staying at thinking I was legit going to die.
Why? What's up?
I remember I'm in bed with Josh, and we're on the side that's facing the AC vent. So I finally fall asleep, and I wake up to what sounds like an airplane is crashing through the building. And my bed's like vibrating, and I look at Josh as if, and he has he's like head down, like eyes bloodshot open, like looking at me like, what the hell is that? And I'm just like, I'm about to die. What this is it? This is it's all ends at a Magic tournament, and then like my adrenaline settles, and I notice that the heater is just like making this incredibly obnoxious noise and is like literally vibrating in the wall.
Wow.
And then so I got up and turned the heat off.
Corey, what? Like the AC unit from the Brave Little Toaster.
yeah. Oh my god, traumatized for life. That, you know what, I bet you if I asked Josh, he'd probably said he'd seen that. And you know what, that like it was, man, I don't know how to describe it. It was like something you heard before, and you're like, there's a train right behind me. No! That's what it felt like.
Yeah, even I woke up for that.
Okay, so I'm really slow, apparently, because I just got the reference that somebody posted in chat earlier, which is that they reprinted Delver at 4 mana.
2 mana, but yeah.
Right. Wait, no, 4 mana. So okay, this is the reference I just got. I was slow on seeing spoilers, but I can post links using my awesome mod powers.
Wait, I know there's a 2 mana Delver. I don't think there's a 4 mana Delver.
Clicky. Clicky, clicky, Bob Wong.
Oh, they put in another one? Hold on, Eric, I gotta check that out then.
It's the same artist, Niles. It's the exact same artist. It's clearly a functional reprint. Or functional.
I don't think you're using the word functional reprint correctly.
Yeah.
I was like, I guess it's two words.
It's a sequel.
Ugh, come on. I need to see this new Delver. I'm sure it's bad.
I posted Skype. Come
I know.
It's really bad.
Sorry, like... Alright, it's loading.
Where are you? Are you in like the Ozark Mountains where your internet is it's like completely terrible?
Oh, I have horrible internet. You already need this. Ooh, this is like...
Very flavorful.
Oh my god, I love it! I love this card! Wow! It's like seeing my little baby. It's like growing up. Wow, okay, that was so great.
A wonderful reaction. I'm glad we
Wow! Oh my gosh! It's like, it's milling. So that's like some extra synergy. And then it becomes like a really fat mother like insect. It's like a mommy Delver. Aww. This is great. Thanks for sharing that.
You're welcome. Anytime. That was delightful.
All right, Jason's under another chalice.
Yeah,
but this is a best board game, so he has access. He has access to Blood Moon, and he has access. I think people were saying Smash to Smithereens.
Well, here's so the other thing. He can't do anything about the library. Like Dale can really get huge advantage out of that because Jason just has to sit there and watch.
I think. Original Delver was great in Innistrad draft. If you could just draft mono Delvers, mono Knights, blue-black Delver can't lose. Because both of those cards were like pretty much last picks. So if you just went on the Delver bump of the night strategy, it was great.
So I believe Salt Level 8 is Stadium Pretzel.
Okay. What if we go up to the next one?
I'm not sure. We have to, whoa, hold on. You can't just double salt like that.
I can't?
No, absolutely
Uh-oh.
Not.
What happens to me now?
We gotta wait before we say more salt, because we didn't do anything to confirm there was more salt.
Okay.
But you have to generate a scale, so you have to go up from Stadium Pretzel.
What's saltier than Stadium Pretzel? Let's see, the instant ramen broth.
Oh, that's a good one.
Yo, the flavor text on this is also sweet.
Bob's still swooning over his Delver.
I mean, the artwork's pretty badass. Niall's artwork's always one of my favorite current artists for Magic.
Man, Jason is on, like, ambushviper.deck.
Ambushviper.deck. Getting in there for two a turn.
Well, Dale's not drawing that much gas either.
Well, that's still in library, though.
He's taking four just to make sure his next draw is a little better.
It's like Molten Vortex in his hand. Oh, well. He's already gonna be able to get the big guy. Or the big gal, actually. Knight of the Reliquary. A woman.
So she's a she?
Yes.
Alright. Let's see what Jason's going for here. Might be Blood Moon. Or Trini and Nemesis. Either one would be pretty good.
Let's see, Jason's deck is all dudes. Right, all the creatures have like male artwork.
Young Pyromancer is a male. That is true. Sometimes I feel like he's wearing a bra.
I think it's a boy, yeah, like a young boy.
I can see your comments, Born Confused. I'm not reading them all the time, but they're there for me.
You can see, just ignoring.
So the knight isn't good for too much here. If he didn't have a blood moon, he could have gone for the combo this turn, because I saw Dark Depths in the top three.
I mean, it's still...
As it is with the blood moon out, he's just going to need to beat face. So yeah, like you were probably trying to say...
Well, the thing is, Dale has Molten Vortex, doesn't he? So he can make that knight very big while still... No?
No, he has. He doesn't play Molten Vortex because he plays Chalice. He added Punishing Fire. Might be what you saw.
Oh, shoot. I probably saw,
man, Jason's, like trying to run so many spells into this Chalice, and Dale's having none of it. He's like, I'm not an idiot, Jason. What do you take me for? Oh, I'm so ready to get my snooze on. Yeah, what do you think of the clues?
The what now?
The Innistrad clues. Blues clues.
Is there something I'm missing about Innistrad?
God, Bob.
I hear a Billy. Is that a Billy?
Yeah, it's Billy playing Smash.
Hey, Billy.
Alright, well, I'll go ahead and I got some packing up to do, and I'm pretty pooped, so I'm probably going to call it there. Do you guys want to tell us a little bit about yourself, where we can find you, if we do want to do that, then I'll close us out.
My name's Diana. I am a human, not a robot.
Prove it!
No. And, I don't know, I'm on Twitter with some handle or something. Alright, Bob.
Wow, you're not even... Wow, that's very private, Diana. Didn't give them your last name, didn't give them your, like, Instagram, didn't give them your Twitter, even.
I do have an Instagram now, wow. I don't know what my handle is.
Okay, well, I'll go then. I'm Bob, Bob Huang. Some people call me a magic celebrity. Other people call me a scumbag. My Twitter is Silly Asian Fool, SILYAZNFOO. Thank you guys for watching. I had a good night. Now I'm going to go get a good night's sleep.
Yeah, thanks.
You can post it in chat, by the way, if you want. But with that note, guys, Diana, Bob, thank you guys so much for taking the time to commentate for us. I really appreciate having you all jump on here. It's cool hearing both your guys' voice again together on the stream. It was awesome.
Ooh. All right, thank you very much for taking our time. thank you for doing this stream and for having us as commentators. All right,
yeah,
good night.
Anytime. You guys are welcome back anytime. If you guys haven't already, make sure to give us a follow or a like. We have links down below that link to our Facebook. Yeah, I'm pretty active on there. I also have links to our Twitter, where I suck at using Twitter, but I'm getting better. You can tweet at me if you want to talk to me. This is Corey, by the way. If you guys haven't, our schedule is listed down below. We try to stream every Tuesday, Wednesday, and Friday, and on the weekends for big events. Coming up this month, we have on the 19th, tentatively, we may be covering a Legacy event in Coopersburg, Pennsylvania. Shout out to Tales of Adventure. They're doing a Legacy 5K satellite series. Check them out if you haven't already. This Sunday, we will be doing, not this Sunday, the 20th, which is the Sunday after that, we will be doing a episodes. I'm getting all sorts of pop-ups for some reason. Oh, it's because of Skype. I'm going to go ahead and call. Sunday, we will be doing... God, not this Sunday. Okay, so the 20th. I'm just going to use dates. The 20th, there is a Legacy Quest for Power series hosted by Squabble / MTG First. They're local for me. So I'm definitely going to be going to that, and that is going to be on the 20th, which is a Sunday. Legacy event. I don't remember what piece of power they're doing. I think Bob said Sapphire or something. Don't quote me on it. Definitely check them out. They're also available on Facebook. All the details are on there. Hit me up on Facebook if you want any of these details for these events, and I'll link them to you. Outside of that, make sure to give us a like if you haven't already. And on that note, I'm going to sign us out. Thank you guys so much for hanging out with us in chat. It's always awesome interacting with everybody and hearing from everyone around the globe. So shout outs if you stuck with us this whole time. Awesome, awesome having you all here. And with that note, I will see you next time.